You are about to participate in the most ambitious culinary experiment ever imagined.
This competition is going to test everything.
Adapt quickly to anything. I mean anything. The wildest day of your life starts right now.
All new 24 and 24 Last Chef Standing. Sunday night at 8 on Food Network. Stream on Max.
About me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
It's not college basketball. It's Clarence
time! Let's get ready to rumble! Feel the fires into the rear. It's my son only know how to
What is up, Friday Nighters? Welcome back to another edition, another episode of Just Another Friday Night. I am one of your two hosts, CM Chuck.
And I'm Double A, everyone.
That's Adamantium Adam, guys. Double A, how the hell are you, bud?
Warm now, finally.
Finally warm.
Cold all fucking week. It's been brutal.
Except yesterday. We had a nice record
day. It was nice.
Randomly.
Ooh, I showed TM the temperatures I was working in. He was like, holy shit.
Yeah,
I believe that's the coldest I've ever worked in.
It wasn't quite Kansas City cold, but it was definitely cold. Where you were up, was it 17?
16 degrees, but it said it felt like one. Mm. So, I was pretty fucking cold.
I am going to have my second beer of the week, my second beer of the year. My nephew has asked me if I could only drink two beers a week. So I said, all right, I'll give it a shot. I had one last Sunday, so it's still the same week. So I was like, all right. Comments rolling in, though, Double A. Let's get to them.
Guys,
oh, shit. Am I at the right one? This one. Toy Mafia in the house.
Number one.
See, the Iceman took out my internet. See, there you go. Toy Mafia, let us know where you are again in the country, in the world. We'd appreciate it. The Dean the Dream himself from Collecting Weekly. Dino says, yo. Let's see. Sam gets in the house. He says, what's up, boys? What's up, Sam? Appreciate your brother. Brenton in the house says, hey, guys. Appreciate you being here, Brenton. Yeah, the Hulk looking good. Steve in the house says, cheers. Steve, give me a second here to pour myself up here. Steve, we appreciate you being here.
For Steve Weiser.
Then take it to cold Steve right here. And I found this old little mug right here. And I was like, well, since I'm only going to drink one, I'll drink out of this little mug. Cheers, Double A. Cheers, Steve. Cheers, Collecting Weekly and Friday Nighters.
Yes, sir. We're in the middle of the month already. 19 days already into January.
Man, that's insane, right, Double A? The time just like blew by, right?
And it just goes like that. You know, before you know, it's going to be end of school, summertime.
I was just telling Double A's wife, I was like, you know what? I was like, it's funny because, like, you know, she was saying she got over being sick and I was sick.
Uh-huh.
And I said, I feel like as we get older and then this time of year, it just like it wears you down differently.
You know how I felt this past December? I told you privately how I was feeling about the holidays more.
Uh-huh. So, yeah, exactly. Uh-huh. Yeah. I said the real holidays are coming up for us adults, which is tax season. So if you don't have to pay back, it can be nice. Sam says the Iceman cometh. I agree with that. And then the face there, it is like, oh man. Always love when you guys show each other love in the chat.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Is this S-Beam? S-Beam says, hello all. Hello, S-Beam. Welcome to the chat. Welcome to the YouTube Live there. Washington D.C. boy. Hey, good old D.C., man. Home of Chappelle. There she is, Miss Aurelis Delgado in the house. Aurelis, I want to know, are you coming in San Antonio by any chance for Riverwalk Anime Con? Just curious. I don't know if your kids are into anime, but I saw this is going to be in April, and there's going to be some cool actors. And my nephew is super excited because the voice actor that does Spider-Man in the Spider-Man games is going to be here. Yuri Lowenthal. If you hear this guy's acting in the second game, Double A, it is excellent, man.
All right.
When he
gets going to take Cal, huh?
Yeah, I think we really want to go, and we think we're gonna try to get some autographs on maybe the game covers and maybe even
definitely
one of
the game
verse figures. And he's also the voice and like the body of the Peter Parker, but also Smoke in the new Mortal Kombat game. So, and he's got a bunch of acting game credits to his name.
That's always fun, right?
Mm-hmm.
I wonder how that line of work is.
Yeah, you know? And also too, I wonder what the pricing is like. I know we've had some good experience with wrestlers and other type actors like that are not, you know, too insane.
They're not too bad. Yeah.
And tickets for a Saturday are only going to be like $31. So that's, I told him, I said, dude, we'll definitely go to that and have a great time. She says they are. I didn't know about it. Well, there you go, Mr. Ellis. It'll be on
sometime in April.
April 13th and 14th. Okay. Yeah. $31 for a Saturday. That's the adult price. There might be a cheaper kid price. I know your little ones are kind of little, so something to think about. Brenton says Spider-Man Crawl Space podcast interviewed Yuri. Oh, very nice. Hey, can we get Yuri on here? I have to reach out to Yuri. My nephew would freak. He was super excited to see the news about that. Absolutely. Then Arella says here, she says, yes, the Space Con is coming, which we're going to get Hayden Christensen. We're going to get Ming-Na Wen is going to come.
I saw Gina Carano.
Yeah.
I'm
very interested in her too, because you know, a little bit controversial, her exiting of The Mandalorian, but I'm excited to see her.
I loved her character.
Yeah.
And then William Shatner. I really would like to try and get him.
Did I see also we're getting the famous beautiful blonde from Deep Space Nine?
Yes, Seven of Nine.
Jerry Ryan, yes. Gorgeous, yes.
Oh, yeah.
and I want to say a different...
Like Data's gonna be there.
Yeah,
Jonathan Brent Franks is gonna be there.
Oh, I love my Riker was my favorite.
Gates McFadden's gonna be there. The Doctor, the one that I think Picard.
Yes,
mm-hmm. Comes from that.
Yeah. Beverly Crusher.
Yes.
Yeah. We're not getting
Q.
Q's coming. Nice. Too.
Me and my wife love Q, and I think Q is one of the greatest science fiction characters ever.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That character is so fucking powerful.
Q, very interesting character.
It's insane how they made him powerful.
Wow, Double A, that's quite a big Star Trek presence for San Antonio Con. We don't think we've really had that before.
No, not like that.
And I know that Trekkies really go all out for their Star Trek people.
With good reason.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, those shows are really good. You know? I think even the captain of the Star Trek Voyager, the female captain, I forget her
Captain
name.
Captain Janeway.
She's going to be here,
oh,
too.
Oh, really? Yeah. And she's got a pretty hefty list of acting credits as well. Does. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
She was a big part of the... my girlfriend and my sister watched Orange is the New Black. Okay. I think she was in the early seasons.
Okay.
Yeah. Captain Janeway. Very cool. Okay. Awesome. I didn't know that we had gotten that many stars.
Yeah. It's a Thomas J. Henry one. So I'm sure, you know, if he is financing it, then
I think
he's able to do it.
I think I saw that the RetroCon that's going to be in New Braunfels
is tomorrow.
And they're getting Jamie Presley. Remember her?
They are.
Yeah, I think so. If I'm not,
I thought you were doing a private signing.
Oh, that's what it was. Okay. I just saw her picture and then the RetroCon logo.
It's kind of cool because like Sergeant Slaughter's going to be there and Larry Hama.
Mm-hmm.
So I was going to go to that and unfortunately something else came up. So I'm like, shit.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to, I wanted Sergeant Slaughter to sign his first appearance of the G.I. Joe.
Okay.
And I wanted more of Larry Hama.
Absolutely. You never get enough of that.
I can't. Yeah, because I mean, I got so much Joe issues. I got so much Wolverine.
What has he signed for you already?
The Silent issue and G.I. Joe number one.
So you went all Joe, no Wolverine.
No, but then I'm like, man, like I checked my Wolverine run, and the run I have the most of is the Larry Hama run.
Yeah.
And then he even wrote Weapon X, the Age of Apocalypse Weapon X. I was like, golly, like there's just so much stuff for that man to. So
I have his signature on.
I'm greedy.
Wolverine 75. Where the
that's beautiful
right after
that's
Fatal beautiful. Attractions
beautiful
75
no. Yeah. I think that is Fatal Attractions.
Yeah that one the one where like Wolverine's like upside down I think on the cover
there's so much good shit that he put into the Wolverine lore that's just like so super iconic.
Absolutely can't agree with you more on that. What else, Double A? Adrenalized me. Was there anything in the world or news of pop culture this week that struck you, that stood out to you this week?
I mean, well, we obviously had the big football playoffs.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Let's talk about that because we know some things happened this weekend, right? I mean, is this the correct one? Do I have the right one up? Or do I have the wrong one up?
Oh, no, it's right. It's right.
Oh, okay. I was like, LVIII.
Yeah, I was like,
hold on. Do I have the right one? Yeah. This is what the
yes, no, this the is setup it. This is.
Let's run it down a little bit, Double A.
Almost all my picks were wrong last week.
Well, I mean, you know, the truth is, I didn't want to agree with you early on when you were picking the Eagles, because I did feel like they were had a very strong chance. But they were going strong in the beginning.
And I
just crossed my fingers for the Bucks, but I didn't think they were going to treat them like that.
I didn't think so either. I didn't think so either. I didn't think Green Bay was going to whip the Cowboys' ass as much as they did. I thought Miami might have had a chance, and Kansas City beat the shit out of them, and Houston just beat the shit out of Cleveland.
A lot of one-sided games.
Yeah,
right?
Well, it's not like last year. Last year was like great big, you know, close games, and this
I think the only thing close was Lions and Rams, which was interesting Stafford Goff story, you know what I mean,
for each of them,
and of course the history. I know that the Lions haven't had apparently I guess a win in like what 32 years 30, or, you 30 know, years so, yeah you know again my feelings about the Lions but you know I guess I'm happy for like Eminem.
But you know what, it's gonna be really cool to see Jared Goff and Baker Mayfield go at it. I think they're both number one picks.
Okay.
So it's going to be really cool to see, because, you know, Baker Mayfield has something to prove.
Mm-hmm.
Jared Goff probably has feel like he has a lot to prove.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's going to be a fun game. San Fran, I think it's going to beat the shit out of Green Bay.
Just a straight up beat down like
that? Yeah, but man, Green Bay, the last two games I've seen them, killing the Cowboys, and I forgot who they killed in the last season of the last team of the season, the regular season, they beat the shit out of them too, man. That Jordan Love looks great.
Yeah.
I mean, people at Green Bay should be super excited for this team.
He could steamroll it. They could be riding that momentum we talked about.
Yeah, and then Buffalo, man, I'm going hard for Buffalo over KC. I like Buffalo more.
Me too.
I love Kansas City, but I love Buffalo more. I want to see them go to the AFC Championship game.
Me too. I love this matchup. I think that game's going to be exciting.
Hey, man, this has to be it for Josh Allen, man. He keeps getting his ass kicked by Mahomes. So,
yeah, yeah. There's got to be a sense of, like, I want revenge. You know, there's got to be a sense of all that. So if they can ride their momentum. And that game I missed because I was watching that Killers of the Flower Moon movie.
That's right. That's
and
right.
My mind slipped that it was that game was that day because they had moved it. And so, of course, that movie's 3 hours and 30 minutes. Would have definitely benefited from some editing, guys. but I was like, oh, fuck, I missed the game, whatever. My dad called me like towards the end. He was like, hey, you're not watching the Bills win? And I was like, oh, shit, I forgot that was on. I was like, so I missed it. But, yeah.
And then the Ravens, Houston. I mean, I want Ravens to win, but it would be cool if Houston does.
It would be cool if Houston wins, of course. You know, Ravens, though, too. I mean, you know, Lamar is great, but I think it could go either way. So, interesting.
It can be really interesting.
Interesting games coming up. Now, what's the lineup, Double A? Do you know for the weekend?
Yeah, it's going to be the number one. So, it's going to be Baltimore and Houston. It's going to be the first game Saturday.
Okay.
I want to say maybe the 3:30 game.
Okay.
2:30, 3:30, and then Green Bay and San Fran is going to be the night game.
Okay.
Of Saturday. And then the Sundays, I can't tell you who's going to be playing first.
All right. We'll have to check a look at that.
Again for maybe a 3 and a 7, or maybe even probably a 3 and a 7.
Okay.
Probably.
Okay. So it'll be two days of football Saturday.
Yeah. So
Sunday.
The number ones are playing Saturday.
Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. Awesome. That'll be good. Always worth watching football, guys, so you can't miss out on
it. I mean, what's so fun about the football playoffs is one and done. That's it.
Yeah, that's it.
Boom. There's no best of 5, no best of 7. Either you suck that day or you're really good that day.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Win or go home.
Win
right?
or go home.
Yeah, I love that. Tomorrow, we're planning to go. I don't know about you, but Ekman's cards collectible
again,
toy show.
That's something else I wanted to go to, but something else came up.
Yeah,
because I really wanted to go to that Retromania.
Yeah,
and I really wanted to go to Ekman's, but I will be at the Wonderland Mall where I will be meeting Doyle, the lead guitarist of the Misfits.
That's right. Oh, I bet that crowd's gonna be nuts.
I am gonna be super excited for that. That's where I'm going. That's where my money's going.
Is he doing one day, AA, two
days?
Okay. And you know prices or?
60 for auto, 40 for picture, or you can get an $80 package for both.
Will he be in makeup, you know?
Or, I don't know.
Have you heard, like, has he in the past done that or not?
I don't know.
If you guys don't know Doyle from the Misfits,
I mean, you just heard the Misfits music.
Incredible, yeah. He's the bassist?
Lead guitar.
And I don't know how big he is, but I know when we saw him live,
he
looked huge.
He's
ripped.
Fucking jacked.
Yeah. And he looks like a Frankenstein. Like, I was like, oh, shit, he really looks like
a buff Frankenstein. Himself looking like that.
Yeah.
It's just one of my all-time favorite bands. Mm-hmm. CM knows how I feel about them. And me and CM and my brother Art actually got to go see Dantic and Doyle do a 30-minute set of Misfits songs.
Yep. And
super exciting.
I think to this day, and I've been at Slipknot and other stuff, to this day that Misfits pit was the craziest pit I've ever seen. Pretty much you guys saved my life, I think, because that pit exploded. You and your brother Boy just immediately pushed people that were near us in like seconds away from us, and I was like, oh shit.
I was nuts. So I am super excited to meet Doyle. That's one of my all-time favorite bands. So
Very cool. He's an American? Okay, all right. I know he goes by like
Jersey.
Ludwig von Doyle von Frankenstein.
Him and Jerry and Danzig are from Jersey.
Okay, I didn't know that. Yeah. All right, very cool.
Him and Jerry, the bassist, are brothers.
In real life?
Yes.
Oh, okay, badass. Uh-huh. Yeah.
So, yeah.
They're not touring with Misfits, are they, though, right? They're not. Is there still Bad Blood?
They've been doing one-off shows. Like in October, they did one in Dallas where Alice Cooper was opening for them.
Oh, wow.
And they did a show in New York where they sold out Madison Square Garden. So
okay, I mean, how long is that tomorrow? Is it all day or
12 to 6?
And I'm like, I kind of want to stop by, man. I'd be badass to see. And I'm guessing does that show tomorrow at Wonderland have a theme? Because there's always like a theme.
Well, so that he's gonna be at the store called Monsters and Mayhem.
Okay,
that's where he's gonna be signing it. Where outside they're gonna be doing the 35th anniversary. I could be wrong. Of Nightmare on Elm Street Part 5.
Okay.
They're having like 6 of the actors show up.
Okay.
So I think that's really going to be the focus of the ground level. I'm sure you're going to see vendors up the ass at Wonderland tomorrow.
Yeah.
The same vendors, shit like that. So.
Yeah, because my dad has gotten in the habit of wanting to go on the weekends just to go see, like not even knowing. And like we happened in the other day and it was a David Bowie tribute or whatever. Yeah. So it was like random.
They do a lot of like events for Wonderland.
I think them and Rolling Oaks, you know, pretty much like the remaining malls in San Antonio have become these hubs of like you know, vendors and these little like theme shows, which is great for the collector because you can go out there and you can run into Funko Pops and banners I mean literally everything. And when there is a theme, it seems like the vendors are really good about bringing forward whatever merch they have for that thing, because I saw so much Bowie stuff. I saw a Michael Myers mask painted with like the David Bowie lightning, and I thought that was really cool. But yeah, people really, you know, seem to get into it, and it's great. I think, you know, those malls really don't have a lot of stores in them anymore. There's not a lot of activity in there, but when those little shows are going on, it's really great.
Yeah, so I'm super pumped. I'm really excited. Cool. The Misfits are one of my favorite bands, and I'm really super excited to meet Doyle tomorrow.
So. Okay, so tell me, what are you getting signed? What are you doing? I have the Misfits box set.
So is it here?
You have it nearby?
No, it's downstairs. I want to have it ready.
So. I want to see before I leave. Yeah, so check it out.
I'm super fucking pumped to meet Doyle.
That would be very bad. The Misfits, excellent band. I always enjoy jamming to them. They're quick songs about horror music. Facebook user says, happy Friday, guys. Facebook user, happy Friday. Tell us who you are, please. For whatever reason, I know sometimes it just happens. The names don't come up, but... You know, it seems like everyone tends to join us on YouTube and everything works all good there. A little bit on our ride over together here, Double A, we were talking about some of the award news going on. I didn't make a slide for it, guys, but we have had, last time we talked the Golden Globes, but now we've had the Emmys pass, right?
Yeah, it's like the SAGs, the Emmys, the Screen Actors Guild, I believe. So, yes. Yeah.
And you were telling me that Robert Downey continues his...
So far, he's been winning, so...
For Oppenheimer, the supporting, so... Yes. Fingers crossed for Robert Downey and the Oscars. Not to say that they haven't screwed people in the past. They've won everything.
Mickey Rourke won everything, only to lose at the end to Sean Penn.
Yeah, which is bullshit. Again, though, I have understood, though, from Hollywood, like what I've read about that, that it's a lot of, like, it's not just, like, how good you do in the movie, but it's a lot of campaigning, and it's about, like, you know, you've got to, like, put ads in Variety and all this stuff.
Well, I mean, Christopher Nolan probably has, so...
Yeah. Oh, Holty Bear in the house. Hey. Holty Bear again. Cheers, buddy. And well wishes to you. Get well soon, bud. Take care of the hand. You know what I mean? So, yeah, John was injured defending a stray animal. And we're hoping he gets well soon. Gets better and back to good. Oh, what else, Double A? Yeah, that award news. You know what I mean? You know, we're hoping for pulling for Robert Downey. Like I said, I don't think I mentioned it a lot. You know, I mentioned it earlier, but I hadn't seen it till this week, but I did see Killers of the Flower Moon. It's now streaming on Apple. It is a long movie. It is a Martin Scorsese movie. It does have excellent acting by Leonardo DiCaprio, Robert De Niro, and Lily Gladstone, who won for the Golden Globe for Supporting Actress. She's stellar in it. Is it a good movie? Yes. Is it a movie I would buy? No. Is it a movie I would watch again? Maybe with someone that hadn't seen it, but probably not on my own because it's long and it would have benefited from some editing. Really cool, interesting story that I didn't know about, but...
I mean, it's like the same, like I saw Last Temptation of Christ from Martin Scorsese. Really good, interesting movie. Again, it's like CM said, though, it was good. I liked it, but would I see it again? Probably not for a good while. If somebody wanted to see it, I probably would sit down and see it because it is good. It is a good movie.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Yeah, I always think about it where it's like, you know, I ended up watching it with Jess, which was great because she actually was interested in seeing it. You know what I mean? But, you know, for me, it'd be like if I was sitting with someone else, like my sister, and she was like, oh, I want to check that out. I'd be like, okay, I'll check it out with you. Like, I don't mind sitting through it again with you. But again, for me, it's not the
thing that I'm going to pop it on again.
Right, or I'd go out and buy. Where there so many of Scorsese's movies I would. Gangs in New York.
Departed,
Wolf of Wall Street, Goodfellas, Casino.
That keep you kind of, keeps it moving, keeps it entertaining.
Yeah, The Irishman is another one that I'm like, I wouldn't watch again. You know, the same thing with Nolan. Nolan has movies that I wouldn't watch. I'm like, I don't ever need to see Dunkirk again. I don't really need to see Interstellar again. I don't really need to see Tenet again. I'm good. But Inception, I would watch over and over.
I guess you can say that with almost anyone, I guess, right?
Yeah, sure. I mean, not the whole catalog is good. For a long time, I felt like Tarantino's catalog was impeccable, but there are ones that I'm not necessarily
going to go back to. Jackie Brown's not really one I go back to a lot.
And again,
I wanted to.
Yeah.
That movie had so many good actors that I like in that movie, and there's not a lot of times I'm like, you know.
Yeah. For me, that's one that I love, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, and I know a lot of people now, it's grown on them, you know, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. I own it, but I don't pop it on
all the time. Yeah, that's another one. If it's too, I'm not just going to pop in willingly.
Right.
If it's on TV, I may stop and watch it, but if it comes to me wanting to put something on, no.
One of the things about this movie, too, Double A for me, was that if I felt like it lacked, like... you know, so many of Scorsese's movies are like quotable and there's like a humor to them. And I get that this was a serious topic, you know what I mean? Obviously, but there's just like something about them, you know, maybe even it comes down to the characters and the redeemability and the likability of them. You know, it's like Leo and De Niro are very kind of unlikable in the movie. And so it's like, you know, there's really nothing for you to like latch onto or whatever. You know what I mean? Where even in like, you know, Goodfellas, where the characters are kind of deplorable, you know, there's so many quotable moments that are fun.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, and again, I highly suggest anyone that hasn't seen it to watch it. You know what I mean? You know, I don't think it's a waste of your time. It's a fine film. It looks beautiful. It's well acted. It is well directed.
I mean, that's Scorsese's hallmark.
Yeah.
You know?
Right. You know, I mean, again, too, I like, why is his name escaping me right now? The Shining.
Jack
Kubrick.
Oh,
Kubrick. I love Kubrick, right? I watched that Barry Lyndon and I was like, "Pugh." Like, no, not for me.
Spartacus is 4 hours from Stanley Kubrick. That's like another one that's really good, but yeah, I'm not really
going to. One time only?
Yeah, I'm like, wow, it's four hours.
Who did we talk to that was telling us that they loved Gone with the Wind? And I was like, oof, that's.
And that's too.
Hey, it's Kaylee Cuoco for Priceline. Ready to go to your happy place for a happy price? Well, why didn't you say so? Just download the Priceline app right now and save up to 60% on hotels. So whether it's Cousin Kevin's Kazoo Concert in Kansas City, go Kevin! Or Becky's Bachelorette Bash in Bermuda, you never have to miss a trip ever again. So download the Priceline app today. Your savings are waiting.
Go to your happy place for a happy price. Go to your happy price, Priceline.
All right, sorry everyone.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, sorry about that, guys.
It's always around this time.
Right, I know, like the first couple of minutes, and I know what that is. But yeah, real quick, some comments there. 14 Wellington in the house says, hi, I appreciate you being here, 14. Sure, this is Holty also says, he says, I love Once Upon a Time. I love it too, great movie.
Uh-huh.
But it is not on my Mount Rushmore of Tarantino movies.
No.
And it's probably not even on the fifth or sixth spot if there were those. Dean says we went dark. Thank you, Dean. Let us know. And we jump back in. I don't know, Dean, what's been happening. This happened to us last week, like in the first couple of minutes. It just StreamYard just kicked us out. Our computer Wi-Fi says it's all the way full. Up.
Yeah.
And even right now, the StreamYard Wi-Fi doesn't show there's any issues. But it just boots us out and boots us back in. So I'll have to talk to the powers that be and see what there is. Kara says, what happened? Kara, didn't even know you were here. Appreciate you being here, Kara. Kara, did you watch Killers of the Flower Moon, and will you watch it?
And even then, you know, it's even kind of like with Kevin Costner. Like, mm-hmm. I like a lot of his movies, but yeah, there's... Like, they're really good movies. Like, Dances with Wolves is a really good movie.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's long. Robin Hood, I love Robin Hood, and that kind of keeps you entertained. But mm-hmm. It's another long movie.
Is it really that long? How long is that?
I want to say it's, like, at least 2.5 hours.
Oh, wow. You know? Okay. Yeah.
You know, Postman, you know, I love that movie, but it's long. Waterworld, I mean, it's just certain people, I guess they feel like they have to make these really long movies. And you know, Costner, again, he's a decorated actor. He's a director. And when you see Dancing with Wolves, it is another one of those movies that it's really good looking to look at. You know what I mean? It's a really good looking movie.
Yeah.
You know?
And I want to say something, Double A, and correct me if I'm wrong. And audience, you guys let me know too if I'm wrong. And real quick, I want to get Dean says, StreamYard kind of whack sometimes, no doubt. He says, it'll say I have no Wi-Fi, but everything else is fine. Yeah, exactly. Kara says, no, I haven't seen it, but I would want to see it. Definitely, I would say watch it. If you come to the house, I've got the Apple TV. I know not everybody has that one, so you could put it on there for you and my sister to check out. So, Double A, I have to say, and it's regarding what we've been saying about the length of movies, right? You know, like, unfortunately, we're in a culture now where people have a much shorter attention span, right? So there's something really, to me... And not because we're in a shorter attention span culture, but guys like Scorsese have gone on note, right? Talking shit about Marvel movies, things like that, right? Not being real cinema, yada, yada, yada.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. I don't agree with that, but fine.
I don't either.
You know, again, and I don't think that those movies are catering to an audience because obviously those movies are long too. Spider-Man was long. Endgame was long. You know, but I feel like when you have a movie like this, Killers of the Flower Moon, at 2.5 hours, it still would have been long. It wouldn't have been as long as 3.5 hours, though. But I'm like, as I watch it, I'm like, there is definitely room for editing. And I feel like there's a pretentiousness about not wanting to cut anything of your movie.
I want
to
say that's going around for a lot of people. I mean, even this
Cameron and the Avatar shit, I'm like...
Even like the latest Indiana Jones and the latest Mission Impossible, those movies had never been a problem, like, issue-wise with time. And then all of a sudden, the last one they want to do, the last Indiana Jones they want to make in almost 3 hours, the last Mission Impossible they want to make in almost 3 hours. It's like...
And
what are you guys doing? Like, you guys are breaking away from what works.
Especially, like
you said, they're trying to put, like, they want you to see their whole vision.
It's right.
Like, no.
not to be shitty, but it's like, okay, that new Indiana Jones, as I love James Mangold, but it's like, you're not Spielberg doing Indiana Jones, so I don't need to see it. And even then, it's like, give me something to buy the Blu-ray for later and watch the deleted scenes or whatever, because it's like, you take away from what an adventure movie is, a popcorn summer movie is, by making it that way. Mission Impossible, I don't give a fuck how many stunts you're doing. I don't want 3 hours of this shit. It's like,
way too much.
That's too much.
That was way too much for the last one.
You know, save something for the encore. You know what I mean? Like, damn, you know, it's like, you fucking do all the hits.
Mission Impossibles have been really good at their set times, but then it was like, this one, he just exploded. I was like, what are you doing? What are you guys doing?
And I think we're going to get to talking about that in this series that we're covering tonight, because this was, in my opinion, Double A, return to form for things that we've been talking about for months now.
Each episode felt like a really good amount of time that you got a lot of information in that amount of time.
And presented in a way that was very palatable and very to the point and very entertaining. I'm like, I want to be entertained. Yep. I want to have fun.
Yep.
I want to enjoy it. And that did this. Wait, what do you think? We just get into it, right? We don't have I don't think much more news. If there's any other news that someone that we didn't mention that you want us to cover, by all means, feel free to pop that comment in and we'll be sure to comment on it. Because for some reason, I don't know why, but I wanted to talk to Double A today about why I was thinking about, I say we're going to start the show, right? Then I sidetrack. But for some reason, I was just thinking about the fucking end of the Mandalorian season 2, right? With the whole Luke thing. In my mind, I was like, that is a moment that in theaters the crowd would have exploded. And I was thinking to myself, when has TV given us that? And I was like, there are some moments where the
the Spider-Man crowd when you see Tobey Maguire and you see Andrew Garfield, the you know, Cap getting Thor's hammer in Endgame moments. There is, those moments are few and far between. And I gotta say, I do not think that DC has given us one of those moments. Marvel has done it, and Star Wars has done it at home, it seems like, lately, and they've done it in things like The Mandalorian.
But they did pop. Like, I still remember when Yoda got the lightsaber the first time. Man,
people Oh, that, yes, I do remember people that big time.
Really hard.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Even I think when, in episode one, when Obi and Qui-Gon first face off against Maul, you know, when the lightsaber ignites, you know, the two sides. I know. So Star Wars has done it. And again, this is where I feel like
DC's, I think that's missing. Actually where everything started from, was from Lucas.
Yeah.
Man, I would still love if I had to, you know, stupid ways of using, but if I could go back in time, I would like to go back to the first screening of Empire Strikes Back, so I can hear people like, when Vader makes it, you know, I'm your father. Like, just to hear that, like, oh my God.
I am your father. Yeah, no doubt, man. I would love to experience that as well. And again, as much as I think about it, like, I'm like, man, did I not wallow enough in the Endgame moment? Like, we lived through that, but yet, I mean, I, that's a moment that I can watch over and over again. It gives me chills, moment.
Yeah.
And, you know, even being with my nephew when we saw Endgame, you know, and sometimes he says now, because already it's been how many years that it's been? Because he was little. That has
been since 2019, so that's already 5 years, because it came out, like, I think in February.
Yeah, too. So he was five, maybe six. And you know, he's like, man, I don't really remember it that well. And I said, oh man, it was amazing. But he does remember Spider-Man, because he's like, you know, when when everyone went nuts when all three Spideys showed up. And again, he's been writing
the Spider-Man. Yeah, but like TM said, I can speak for both of us. When that moment happened, when Cap finally got the hammer.
Oh yeah.
I mean, we just all exploded. Yeah. I mean, it was just like, wow.
You know.
And what was cool about that, and see, this is what I kind of hate when they always say, well, you know, the Marvel is not real cinema, or comic books are not real cinema. If you looked at that theater, you saw people of all ages, all fucking ages, and they were really into it. I mean, that was a really great movie.
Joe in the house says, boys, what's up? Jumping in really quick.
But hey, it's happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Jen. Wife. Happy birthday to Mrs. Joe. Mrs. Now Watch This.
Hell yeah.
We hope she has a really happy birthday. Send her our love, Joe, and we hope that it's a great birthday. I know that you will make it so.
Hell yeah.
And we'll see you, Joe, next week, hopefully. But yes, AA, all things true. I mean, regarding that, and you know, again, I was thinking about that moment so much, because I was like, man, that moment at the end of The Mandalorian would have just drove people crazy. And if you watch reactions online, I mean, you see it. I mean, people are like, holy fuck, like, it's Luke. Like, it's like, you know, and then you just see him being like the Luke that we've read about.
Expanded universe lore Luke,
like Jedi Master Luke, you know what
pretty
I mean?
Pretty much it was
Jedi
like,
Grandmaster Luke.
Pretty much it was like what Anakin should have been.
Right.
What he was always, what they were always supposed to be.
Mm-hmm. What they talk about the Empire being afraid of Luke Skywalker, and you're like, huh? Like, why? And you know what's great too is that, because it's like, you know, these battle droids or whatever, he gets to be so merciless. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, it's not cutting down people, but he's cutting down these machines, and it's like they are no match whatsoever. And you know, if I had to think, there probably are some great moments, like maybe when Ahsoka appears, people would have cheered. Maybe not to that extent, because it's not her going off. But even the Ahsoka show, maybe when Anakin appears, people would have had an equivalent reaction.
Definitely would have popped.
But I definitely think that right now Star Wars is looking for that Luke Skywalker moment from the end of The Mandalorian Season 2 again to have, you know, that type of moment, you know?
Again, I think when Force Awakens, when Harrison Ford pops up, I do remember people pop for that.
Yes,
of course. Because it was kind of like, oh, shit, Han Solo's back. Like, finally, you know? So that was cool.
Yeah.
And people were pretty pissed off when he got killed.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
I remember that part in the theater, too.
I think like, people booed in my theater. Shit. Yeah, people booed. Yeah, I was like, ooh.
They were upset.
Yeah, no doubt. Dean says, in episode 7, when the camera pans over to the Falcon for the first time, huge cheer. Yes, absolutely. Yes. Yeah. I can remember seeing the trailers in theaters, and that scene where it comes up, the Falcon comes up and then goes down, like the whole, like, I was like, damn, we're in the trailers. You know what I mean? So it's like, but you know, just incredible moments like that. I mean, I feel like, you know, I guess maybe what had me thinking about it is the fact that Scorsese makes this long ass movie. Right. And it's like, and it's a very, very good, fine, beautiful looking film.
It's like
film.
You said, you don't need to show your whole thing.
Right.
editing would have been good. I'm sure the bosses too would have been like, maybe it could have chopped it here.
Yeah. Here. And you give him his due because he's Martin fucking Scorsese. But at the same time, like, you're going to talk about, I hate to say it, but I mean, it's like, that movie is not drawing people to the theater. No. Moments like what Star Wars and Marvel have given us are bringing people to the theater. And the theater's hurting. It's floundering.
And you know what, Sam? What kind of sucks, too, is that they just focus on comic book movies. But when you look at, like, some of the early hits, what was, like, number one? It was, like, Star Wars was the number one movie. Mm-hmm. Then it was, like, E.T., an alien movie.
Yeah.
Then you had, like, Jurassic Park, a dinosaur movie. Then you had Independence Day, an alien movie. You know what I mean? It was always those movies that were in the top ten.
Right.
Batman, Superman. You know, it was the Rocky films that were drawing people in. Absolutely. You know what I mean? It's like they forget all of a sudden what Spielberg was doing and George Lucas were doing. Right. You know what I mean?
Right.
I mean, it's
sci-fi, stupid. Fantasy, you know.
Those are the top ten movies.
Absolutely, yeah. You know? The unknown. You know,
it's like you said, the movie theater should be like, shut the fuck up, man. Like, these are the ones that you can bring your whole family to.
Right.
Killers of the Flower Moon, you can't take Cal with
no
you.
No way.
Fuck no. No way.
He'd be bored to tears,
You take him to see Spider-Man, hell yeah. Absolutely. That's when you get the father, you get the wife, you get the kiddies.
Yeah.
You buy more popcorn, you're buying more drinks. Mm-hmm. You know, you're fucking spending time at the theater, you're spending, you know, at least $10 a ticket per person. That's what the people want.
Well, real quick, saying regarding that, you know, you mentioned the Rocky movies, and I just want to say those are also movies that you get so engrossed in the characters and the story that's going on that when those fights are happening, you know, again, I wasn't in those theaters to see them, but I can imagine that those are some movies that crowds would cheer for. My girlfriend cheered when we watched the Creed movies.
Exactly.
And he finally, like, you know, starts to beat the guy up. You know, she's like, yeah, like, woo. She gets, like, hype. You know what I mean? And I'm like, see, these are the kind of movies that do that. I mean, like, it doesn't have, like, you know, you're right. It doesn't have to be a superhero movie, but it does that.
Could care less about the whole history of Spider-Man, but she'll go there because she knows she'll have a good time.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Dean saying willfully ignorant. I think referring to the whole way that, you know, the Scorsese type of comments. Yeah. Matthew Sanchez in the house. What's up, Matt? Appreciate you being here, brother. And then Dean says, it's not real cinema. Yeah, his last movie came out on Netflix. Martin needs to shut the fuck up. Joe says, do we miss one of Joe's comments here? No. I think he did. He said, he says, when Solo says the Force is real. Absolutely. Yeah. He says, you still trying to buy a special cut with De Niro?
No, you're not. You really aren't.
No, you're not. You don't want it. You're like, I'm good on that. Facebook user, it might be mad again. He says, last movie I remember cheering for was Endgame. Yeah. Absolutely. And this Facebook user says, yo, Facebook user, please identify yourself.
That's what the movies were made for, to see these big fucking movies. Even Avatar. As much as we really don't like Avatar, that movie, James Cameron makes movies for the big screen.
Right.
You know what I mean? When it comes to Terminator 1 and 2, Avatar 1 and 2, Titanic, even that movie was made for a big screen.
But at
James Cameron knows.
At the same time, though, AA, do you feel as though he's also one of these pretentious guys that could have benefited from some editing?
You know what? I would have said no on the earlier movies. If you took the Avatar movies out, I would have said no.
Right.
Because Aliens was really good. It's a good, fast-paced.
Yeah.
Even though it's long, it's fast-paced. It keeps you entertained.
Yeah.
Terminator 1 and 2 keep you really entertained.
Yeah.
Titanic, I don't know. I mean, people loved it. So.
Well, I feel like with that one, the end half hits harder because he spent so much time building up the two characters. So you're like, okay, like, but in that sense.
What I mean is that James Cameron at least knows.
Right.
Like, okay, Avatar's going to be a long movie, but you know what? You're going to love looking at it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
Where Scorsese's, and even Tarantino, even you said Tarantino too.
He needs Sally Menke.
They want you to really just look at one scene for a really long time and really pay attention to the dialogue. At least with Avatar, you can pay attention to what they're saying, but man, you can be like, man, look at that fucking animal, look at that creature, look at that tree floating up there. That's why I always like James Cameron, because at least he knows, I might make some long movies, but you're going to love what you're looking at. You know what I mean?
And I love Tarantino, but I will say his films haven't been the same since his longtime editor, Sally Menke, passed. That's when we started to get, like, the longer movies, like the Django's and the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood's and the Hateful Eight movies, where it's, and also too, as his stock has ballooned, you know, beyond anything, no one's going to tell him no. So it's like, why leave anything on the cutting room floor? We'll just put it all in there.
You know,
like,
what the thing I guess you can say with Tarantino is that he's not making a $200 million film. right. like Scorsese was with Killers of the Flower Moon.
Right.
How can you really justify $200 million for what you're looking at? Right? Yeah. You pay $200 for Killers of the Flower Moon and you give it to this, or you give $200 to James Cameron who's going to give you Avatar?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? There's a big difference there.
Absolutely.
I'm like, wow, that Killers of the Flower Moon cost that fucking much? Like, mm-hmm. wow.
Yeah, and wow. I didn't know that that was a budget. Yeah.
Yeah, I was like, wow.
Yeah, and that's like, I mean, the studio has to know that's a huge gamble, because what are you writing
it
on?
Is
you're writing on star power, you're writing on his name. You're
writing on Scorsese and DiCaprio. That's really who you're writing your
I mean, on. Even the fucking title doesn't really allude to anything. It's not Scorsese doing the fucking mafia again, you know what I mean? So you're like, what's going to go on? Like, and what are we
that's
trying
just really
to...
the big difference. You're looking at a really, what, does... Oklahoma? Is that where it is? Uh-huh. Look at a dusty Oklahoma versus Pandora.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, yeah, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Good comments rolling in here. I'm going to get to these real quick. It says, I would love to see Alien in theaters again. Absolutely. Uh-huh. You know, I hate to say this, but the Alien movies are something I didn't watch so much later in life.
Same here.
And
same
I remember,
for me too.
Yeah.
Same for me too.
I remember watching Alien alone in my living room being like, creeped the fuck out. I was like, this is like
too.
A fucking horror movie.
I was
like, it's fucking scary. And that scene at the end when it jumps out of her, I fucking jumped. I was like, oh, fuck.
And then when I saw Alien, I was like, wow, like you can turn this easily into a video game.
Absolutely.
Where people can have like fun with this.
Yeah.
You know?
So much fun, that one for sure. Facebook user, identify yourself if I got to your name's not coming up for whatever reason. Maybe this is still Matt. I'm not sure. Joe says,
I watched The Irishman for the first time recently. Had to watch in pieces. It's a long watch and was expensive, but didn't do well in the box office.
Yeah.
That was another one, too, that for some reason, that costs a lot of money.
Yeah.
And you're like, why am I paying a whole lot of money for this? Honestly.
You know, and I didn't like it, and I think some of it had to do with the de-aging of De Niro, but not getting hit. Maybe that's what cost a lot. But then it seemed like he was still his body, because even, you know, our friends Friday Nighters and former guests Holty Bear and Foxy Roxy said, they were like, man, when he's doing that beatdown, they're like, it looked pretty...
He looks old.
They should have got, like, a young guy's body to at least do the
which
that
they
part.
Did with Mark Hamill, didn't they?
I think so. Oh yeah, all the movements in the Star Wars is a young guy. Yeah. And now here's where he improved on that in Killers of the Flower Moon. De Niro is an old guy playing an old guy, and he plays the old guy very, very, very Robert De Niro-ish and very well. And he's very, excuse me, unlikable and ruthless. So, you know, I guess he realized, well, I'm not gonna try to make a young guy movie with De Niro and have him DH because I can, because that's not gonna work.
No.
Leave that to the superhero movies there. Scorsese. Facebook says Avatar is definitely ADHD peeps. Yeah. Because you need like constant stimulation.
You're looking at all that scenery, you're chewing it up.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right. Austin Nichols in the house says surprisingly like the Twisted Metal theories.
I was really surprised too, Austin. I was like, wow, CM, you need to get on this. I go, it's only 10
Absolutely.
Episodes and they're only 30 minutes, but man, this was a fun fucking ride.
No, and you're not late, Austin. I see your later comment. Stick around, man, because we're about to get into the show. I meant to segue into that. I got on my soapbox as podcasters do.
I think this might be Matt.
Matt says, okay, he says, feel like, go ahead, Double A. I have my glasses on, guys.
He said, feel like Avatar and a few other action or superhero flicks were the only few event movies coming out recently.
Mm-hmm.
Just rewatched the Lord of the Rings trilogy. Well, I did too.
Mm-hmm.
Got super hyped watching it again. So did
Absolutely.
We need a new event movie and or trilogy to be excited about. And that's what I told CM about. It was like when Fellowship came out, people loved it.
Mm-hmm.
Two Towers came out, it fucking built up. And then Return of the King, everybody showed up to see the ending,
yes,
you know what I mean?
Totally.
Yeah.
And that probably helped it eventually garner the awards that it did garner.
Uh-huh.
Speaking of Foxy Roxy, she's in the house.
Hey, Roxanne. She goes, I'm a Scorsese fan. You know,
as
I
are
love
we?
Casino and Wolf of Wall Street. I watch those over and over. But there's a point in anyone's career where you don't reach the audience like you used to. Oh, man, don't get mad because you don't understand today's audience.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. He keeps thinking, like, everyone's going to show up for his movies. Like,
right.
Man, no, you don't pay $200 million for that.
Yeah, and also too, don't attack. You
oh,
know,
man.
The world's
okay.
changing.
Man,
don't attack the people because the audience has changed. You're still a great filmmaker, but it's not. We're not dumb because we don't want to sit through your 3.5 hour movie at the theater when I can probably watch it in better sound and more comfortable at my house where I can relax for 3 fucking hours. I mean, it's like I want to get up and pause and go pee. It's like. Dude, the times have changed. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you got to get with the program,
yeah,
bro.
Because, you know what? Endgame was like almost 3 hours, mm-hmm. but hardly anybody was getting up to go pee for Endgame.
Nope. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Arlene in the house. Arlene says, Matt recently made me watch the third one regarding Lord of the Rings, which good job on you, Matt. Well done, Matt. And Arlene, what did you think about that third one? De Niro was too damn over for Return of the Irishman.
What I love about De Niro, though, is he can still act. That man can still go. He's done way better than Pacino has, which I'm like, every time I see Pacino now, I'm like, damn.
And I will say, proven so in this movie because he does a fine job.
De Niro's always going to be fucking De Niro stellar.
Does a fine job. Yeah. Although I did see Pacino in something fairly recently and I thought that he was really good in it.
But you know, his movies haven't been as consistent as De Niro's performance.
Yeah, he hasn't been as consistent. Damn, I want to think about what that is. Somebody give me a new Pacino movie. Arlene then says, Matt recently made me watch the Alien movie with the outer space jail. What'd you think of that one, Arlene? That one I remember was like, the classic scene or the,
but it's kind of gotten a little bit more,
it's grown on people,
it's grown on
people. Used to be considered like the bad one, but of those
two, Resurrection King.
Yeah. Joe says, I recently rewatched Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, man, that's, you know, I fell in love with that series all over again.
Yeah, and Joe says, I currently need an original Marvel Red. And I really want to do that with my nephew as well. Man, he's been saying he wants to watch Daredevil, and I'm like, all right, let's go. We watch all of Echo together. Yeah. So I think that really put him in the mode. And I said, oh, you will love that.
Okay, your face too heavy?
No. I think it'll be fine. Well, because it's not good. I'm always, to me, heavy is if there's like gratuitous sex.
I'm talking about, because I mean, there is a lot of dialogue in the Daredevil series. You know, the fight scenes are fucking excellent. Some of the best, but... You know, there is kind of,
I feel like,
talk.
I feel like with how we got through Invincible, he's ready, I think, for like the Marvel Netflix shows, I think. Well, Daredevil, not the other ones, because I think Jessica Jones is too talky.
I remember I was going to watch that one with my daughter. Yeah. And, you know, it was like, there's like a lot of sex in Jessica.
Yeah, that like, one. Oh, yeah, definitely.
Shit, I can't watch it with you anymore, you know, so.
Let's see here.
Often says most movies I'm watching them at home. Some movies deserve the movie experience, mm-hmm. though. Star Wars, Infinity War,
absolutely,
and games, some horror movies, etc.
Agree.
Yes. But you're not gonna see, I'm sorry, but you know, Killers of the Flower Moon. As much as I would have liked to see it because it's Scorsese, because I like Scorsese, that's a movie that me and my wife were like, you know what, we'd probably be more comfortable watching it at home because of what she said.
Yeah.
Pause it. You know, pee breaks, get something to drink, you know, that kind of stuff, you know.
I'm not going to lie to you. As much as I wanted to see Oppenheimer, as much as Nolan said, you got to see it in IMAX.
And it was cool seeing it on IMAX, but that's another one too.
Right. I've been waiting. I'm waiting until the 16th when it comes out on Peacock, and that's when I'm going to watch it. I very much want to see it, but to me, I was like, I don't think I want to go sit through that at the theater or whatever, and it doesn't. And I love film, and I'm a cinema buff.
I am too, I love it.
And you know, part of it is what me and you talk about. A lot of times it's like, it's great that we have each other, you know what I mean? And some of the Friday Nighters and the collecting weekly family. But it's like, sometimes it's like, you know, your old lady doesn't want to go with you to that. Or you have friends that are like, I don't really want to go see that. My nephew's at the movies right now watching Godzilla Minus One again, now in the black and white version, because he loved that much. He got me to watch this week the Shin Godzilla movie. Have you seen this one? So this is like from 2016 AA, and it's kind of like, I guess, supposed to be, I'm not the hugest Godzilla aficionado, so I really can't say. But boy, we watched it at home, and it was fucking excellent. I was like, yeah, damn, this movie is badass. Like, Godzilla was badass. I told my nephew immediately after that, I said, I would buy this. I would watch this again. And, you know, we just did a rental, and he went back the next day and was watching just the Godzilla scenes, and it was enjoyable. And I was like, damn, this one was a really enjoyable story. The creature was cool. It did cool shit. It's called Shin Godzilla. I don't know if it was supposed to be like a, like a remake of the first one, but like in 2016, but it's done by Japan, by the original company Toho. Okay. And man, I was just like, damn, this shit was like, I was like, it was badass. Like the way they handle it, AA, like the people, you're kind of okay with the human part because they're handling it the way they would be like if it was really happening, like a real crisis. And like they even like, America's aware and they're going to send in support and they're attacking the monster, but like nothing's happening. And they're like, well, fuck, we got to devise this plan. And of course, you know, and spoilers for anyone that hasn't seen Shin Godzilla, so I'm sorry. But by the end, they're like, okay, we're going to fucking nuke it. Like America's like, we're going to nuke it. We know it's in Japan. So like, get as many people out of the island of Japan as you can, unless you can do something else. So they're like, we got to do this right now or there's not going to be no Japan. So you're like, damn, like the intensity is really there. Like I was like, this is a fucking fine film. I was like, after watching earlier in the week, a 3-hour also very good film, but it wasn't one that I was eager to say I'd see again. You know what I mean? So despite it being quote unquote true cinema. So that's a lot of ranting there. Let me see here.
Right there.
Right here, Roxanne.
De Niro's an amazing actor, but no matter how good he is, he cannot play a 30-year-old man when he's 75. Oh, no.
Right. No, not at all. Yeah. And he very well plays a 75-year-old man in this Killers of the Flower Moon movie. Again, if you have not seen it, watch it for his performance.
But Roxanne, what I'm saying, though, is that at least he's kept up his chops.
Yeah.
Where most old actors really don't, he's kept it up.
Austin says, I just had Rachel watch the Daredevil series for her first time. And that Daredevil series.
Austin, I loved 1 and 2, but man, season 3 is what got me. Because I had like everything Frank Miller on season 3. When they introduced Bullseye, I was like, oh man.
Yeah. And for me, it's season 2 with the Punisher, man.
You know how much I love Bullseye.
Don't get enough.
Kingpin in that series. Well, it's like,
again, too, just the show looks good. It's directed well. It's acted well. It has everything.
They gave it the tone that Daredevil needed.
And as double A, as a Daredevil reader of the comic, to say it hits all the Daredevil notes is a high compliment to me. The highest compliment. Joe says Jessica Jones definitely not for kids.
Yeah,
maybe this is Matt again. Oh no, this is Arlene. She says
he made us watch the extended edition of Lord of the Rings, and it was good. But I couldn't get over how Wood couldn't just place the ring in the leather bag and tie it in a leather necklace to prevent him from getting so fatigued.
Mm-hmm.
And the Alien movie was great. I want to pay $200 to see it in a theater.
Oh, okay. Okay. You would pay $200 to see it in theaters, you'd be willing to pay that much to see it in theaters. Yeah, absolutely. And Arlene, if you go back to our Lord of the Rings episode, I do talk about how the One Ring makes you very horny. Because Frodo was so fucking horny during that movie with the ring. I was like, bro, chill out. It's the biggest aphrodisiac. Joe says, I've watched all the Marvel movies in theater. I don't think I've seen all of them in theater.
I didn't get to see Guardians, which I hit myself over my head because I didn't see that first one.
Yeah.
I didn't see... I saw all the Iron Mans. I saw the Caps.
I didn't see the Marvels.
I didn't see...
Obviously, yeah.
I didn't see Thor Ragnarok. I didn't see that one.
I saw that one, yeah. I think I've seen almost all the Marvel movies. I'm trying to think what I didn't
see. There's been a few I haven't seen.
But like I know I didn't see the Marvels. There might have been something before that. I don't know. No, I may have seen almost all of them in theater.
There's a few I haven't. So.
Yeah, I rolled the dice on some for sure. Joe says, hell, I don't think we would have done everything everywhere all at once without Chuck and Joe. Meaning Lucky. Yes. It was Lucky's idea, really. He was like, let's go see this.
I remember. Right. Yeah.
And I went, and I was extremely hungover during that viewing. Yeah. But still a great movie. Arlene says...
Matt just made us watch that one, too. Shin Godzilla was freaky, especially the last transformation he could have turned into.
Yeah, and they did a great job of making Godzilla look, like, scary, double A. Like, even my nephew was really? Like, man, that Godzilla was kind of scary in this one. Right now, I was like, yeah, it was scary looking. Like, I was like, it looked... you know, monstrous, you know what I mean? Like, it's still Godzilla. I'm telling you, man.
Damn.
I'm
popular opinion, but I didn't like the Guardians.
All three, Roxanne, none of them stood up to you? Like, let us know. Then we hear it. Matt says?
Matt says, Shin Godzilla was badass. Mm-hmm. And it's a little political, but also different perspective. Minus one, definitely just a badass, if not more. Both Shin and Minus One definitely had better human character-driven stories than the American legendary Godzilla movies. So I also like, but still, he also likes the legendary Godzilla movies.
Absolutely, and I think that's the monster flicks tend to take flack for like the human story either being not good or focus too much. You want to see more of the monster.
Yeah, because I'm kind of like that too. Sometimes I'm like, man, what's with the fucking humans?
No doubt. Roxanne says, but I did like the characters. Okay. I think you're referring to Star-Lord, Groot, you know, Gamora, Nebula, the Guardians, obviously. She says, yeah, didn't care for the movies, but it had moments in all three films. Okay, awesome. All right, guys. Yeah, I don't want to keep the ball rolling away from the topic at hand, but I hope that you guys are going to enjoy this one for sure. But great comments. Thank you, guys. I hope that you will all stick around for this conversation, because if you haven't seen it, I will let you know there are spoilers abounding here. And we always do our best, though, of leaving there being something for you guys to still and watch, because there's no way that we could possibly talk about every detail of a 10-episode show. Guys, but we watched, Double A and I watched, again, Double A first on his recommendation, the Peacock original series, Twisted Metal. If you guys don't know Twisted Metal, based on a popular game, I think it first came out on the PlayStation. The 1995 is what I think I read. Yeah, so it was a video game. And Joe, as quick, the first one to ask the question, you got to ask, did y'all play the game? I didn't, but I remember it being played. I remember it being like being around people playing it. I may have even have played it like on a demo or something like that at one time or another, and thinking it was cool, but not really, you know, getting into it where it was something that I was going to go buy or enjoy in that way. Joe, did you play the game? And if so, what did you think of it? But I did know when it got announced, I was like, oh, they're doing Twisted Metal. I knew it was based on a video game. I knew about the clown, Sweet Tooth. Obviously, you see him here on top of the on top of the ice cream truck. That was like what it was known for. That was its hallmark. But yeah, it came out in June, right? Double A?
Mm-hmm.
June. So it's been out for a little while now. And we, what, just slept on it? Double A?
Big time.
Yeah, we slept on it. Yeah. What got you to want to watch it, Double A?
Well, I had just got Peacock again.
Okay.
And I saw it was on there, and I was like, I checked it out. I was like, 10 episodes, 30 minutes. And that's kind of the thing that really caught me. I was like, cool, 30 minutes. All right, let me see how it is. I like Anthony Mackie. And I was like, I remember Samoa Joe's Sweet Tooth. So I was like, let me check it out. Checked out the first one. Saw my wife. I go, oh, I told my wife, I go, you're going to like it. This is like a dystopian show.
Mm-hmm.
She saw it with me.
I know you loved it. Post-apocalyptic world stuff.
She fucking loved it. So we started watching it. I think we finished it in 2 days. Because we probably would have finished it in one, but we started off late. We started like at 7 o'clock. On the first day,
yeah,
and then we finished it the next day.
I think I finished it in 2 days too, maybe three, but only because we had football this weekend, so I was like watching it in between everything else.
Yeah.
Joe says, I did play the game, the OG game, and maybe to a demo of Black, which I remember that one coming out too, and always seeing that twisted clown face and knowing that I was like, oh, that's fucking Sweet Tooth or whatever. Yeah. Absolutely. Then here we have Facebook user says, share your Peacock login. Absolutely. Hit me up, Bob. Hit me in the DMs, Kenny? And we'll see what we can work out for you. Who?
Kenny?
Peacock? Kenny? Oh, I don't know. Is that one, guys? I don't know. I know that me and Double A been talking about how some of them have gotten more strict where they won't let you share or whatever, which I'm like, I don't know how they do that, but.
What I do like about Peacock, real quick, guys, if you guys don't have it, apparently, I guess you can see the movies. Well, they'll show the ads. On the beginning.
At the beginning.
And then you can see the whole rest of the movie the rest of the way. I was like, damn, I love that.
I love that too. Everyone would do that.
Fucking do it.
I hate when it's in the middle, like regular commercials. I'm like, come on, just put them up front. So, you know what I mean?
Peacock is really good.
Absolutely, yeah. And obviously you see right here some of the cast. As Double A mentioned, we are huge fans of the wrestler Samoa Joe, and he is the body of the clown, Sweet Tooth, whose body you see there. But he is voiced by Lego Batman himself, Will Arnett. So I was a little disappointed to hear that Joe didn't get to do the voice, but it's all good.
Me too.
He does great work with his body and his movements and his eyes. So I was still very impressed with Samoa Joe, who uses his real name, I think, Joe Sanoa.
Yeah, Joe Sanoa.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is pretty cool. So I'm really happy, really proud of Samoa Joe. I had the pleasure of meeting him in real life at a gym here in San Antonio when he was with WWE NXT. I mean, you gotta love Samoa Joe, man. I mean, he's fucking awesome.
Which he's a current AEW heavyweight champion.
I did not know that. Yeah. Man, badass.
Yeah.
And then we have right there, obviously, Falcon himself, also Captain America now, Mr. Anthony Mackie, and we're going to talk about him a little bit here. And then, to me, newcomer, but if anybody knows what other work she's been in, but Stephanie Beatrice, who plays, as she's called right now, Quiet. Her character is called Quiet. I didn't know her from anything else, Double A, you? Stephanie Beatrice?
No.
Anything else?
No,
and I didn't look up her IMDb, so, I mean, I can, but I didn't know her from anything else. Let me see here real quick, some comments rolling in, and I want to get to you guys while you guys are still hanging out with me. Joe says, I already share mine. okay. Regarding his Peacock, there. So he says, and Arlene says, share with me, LOL, I'll hit you up. Okay, all right, people want to watch Peacock. If you guys are going to watch the show, then I'll share with you guys. You know what I mean? Joe says, I got Peacock for The Office and WWE. Love watching The Office on Peacock, as well as Parks and Rec. And I often forget, Joe, that WWE is on there, but, you know, also love wrestling. Joe says, bullshit that they didn't even put Joe's name in the credits. No, they did.
They do, but
under Joe Sanoa, I guess he wanted to use his like his real name, not Samoa Joe, because then.
Which good on him.
People, you gotta use your shooting, your Your shoot name. I was going to say, wait, your what name? Yeah. So Arlene says, does the clown sound like Batman? Because that would be super cool. Yeah, he sounds a little bit like that. But he says much cooler shit than Batman. Trust us on that, Arlene. Matt chimes in. Sweet Tooth reminds me of Sean Cunningham from Slipknot. Both badass. Yeah, very
love
nice.
Slipknot, man.
And then Dean says, psych. Yes, on Peacock. Peacock is Parks and Psych marathons. Absolutely on Parks. I have not seen Psych, Dean, so don't curse me, but I've always heard good things. A classic USA show that came on after wrestling.
Yeah, I remember.
On the USA days.
Yeah.
Now, real quick, guys, I want to read this to you guys because I went to IMDb for quotes because I wanted to get the quote that Anthony Mackie does at the beginning of the show, the first episode when the series starts, because I told AA what this show does extremely well is that not only, like AA said, is it very the right length, I was like, but it gives you, like, everything you need really quickly, and then you're like, okay, I'm good to go now, and I know exactly what's going on.
Yes.
So, and I put this in our write-up as well, so you can read it there, but I'm going to read
again,
it to
we
you.
Kind of, like, had said earlier where people want to show every bit of footage from the movie.
Right.
This one, like CM tells you, he tells you right away what happened to the world and what's going on, what he does, how the fucking United States is. I mean, he gives you a full detail explanation within like 10 minutes.
Yeah, and I think even I think even one of the ads was saying making the apocalypse fun again.
Yeah,
which I kind of felt like might have been like a jab at like maybe The Walking Dead and other stuff where you're like,
no
man, it's such a bummer as the apocalypse would be, but this show does make the apocalypse kind of fun again. So real quick, what it says here, and Anthony Mackie, again, it's even less than 10 minutes, guys. He says at the beginning, and it wasn't in IMDb in the quotes yet, so no one's written it in there. So I may go add it to IMDb, because I had to actually watch and pause and watch and pause and watch and pause. But this is what he says in Anthony Mackie's, actually not even in his voice, in his character's voice, John Doe, the milkman, because he's way cooler than he is in fucking Falcon and the Winter Soldier or even the Avengers stuff. So he says, 20 years ago, the world fell to shit. A big old apocalyptic dump. Some bug took out all the world's computers. Power grids down. The internet gone. And not having easily accessible porn freaked people the fuck out. So cities put up walls to protect themselves and threw the criminals out into the chaos. So they could fight over what was left, which was not much. Mostly cars and guns. Now, insiders stay inside and outsiders stay outside. But there are people who drive between. Badasses, legends, humble motherfuckers like me delivering precious cargo from one walled city to another. It's not an easy road because all these assholes want what I got. And that's where the cars and the guns come in.
And all while he's saying this, there's like a whole bunch of action going
on. Lots of action.
During that whole little speech.
And again, I like video games. I've heard of this video game, wasn't an avid fan. But when AA told me this show, I was like, okay, AA, like, why are you watching? All right. And I was like, he told me this in another show. He was like, watch one or watch the first couple minutes of one. And if you get into it, go for it. If not. And I was like hooked, like quick. You know what I mean? Like they already had like the cameo of the game appeared on his windshield. And like, so direct reference. And I was immediately too. I was like, Anthony Mackie, are you fucking cool again? Like, I was like, bro, you haven't been this cool since you were fucking Clarence in fucking 8 Mile. You know what I mean? I was like, okay, this is a different Anthony Mackie. And the ball was off to the races, right? So, I mean, it was like, okay, this is a...
It was so good because it's like each episode was something different where he would go into some other kind of community, but it would be done with in that episode. It was almost like it didn't stay very long. Like for one, two episodes, like The Walking Dead would.
Right.
The Walking Dead would stay on one fucking space for like 3 episodes.
Yeah.
From each person's point of view.
And how about every payoff you had to wait for?
Yeah.
Like every payoff. Well, when are they going to get this guy? When are they going to get that guy? When is this going to happen?
It's kind of like boom, 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 boom.
Right. Right. Very much so. Yeah. So, again, our primary characters, you can see right there, some of them, and we're missing one, which is played by Thomas Hayden Church.
Agent Stone. I didn't know
he was in it. Yeah. Agent Stone. He's in Thomas Hayden Church, great actor, so he gets to come into the fray here. Joe says real quick, Will Arnett is also a producer.
Okay,
I did see his name in the producing credits. And he says, Peacock's treatment of sitcoms during the holidays is awesome. Cannot deny that. Love those Christmassy and holiday episodes that they all put out. Also, Friends, right? Friends on Peacock as well?
No.
Oh, it's not.
No, Friends is just on Netflix.
Oh, Max.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I don't know why I thought. Maybe I thought because it used to come on
Netflix. It used to be on Netflix.
Interesting. And Joe says, Sandman. Yes, Sandman from Spider-Man 3. The best villain in that movie. Easily.
Easy. Yeah.
And he's back in No Way Home too, right? It is him. It's Thomas Hayden Church. Yeah. And he's excellent in this as the antagonist. But again, we have Stephanie Beatriz there as Quiet, and then Anthony Mackie as John Doe, the Milkman, and then Samoa Joe / Will Arnett as Sweet Tooth. Now, we don't get to meet Sweet Tooth until episode 2, but still, I thought that was cool that he came out really quick, because my first thought as I started watching, I was like, when is Sweet Tooth going to come out? And so when I got him right in episode 2, I was like, badass. They brought him out right away, you know? So, take me through the paces, though. What did you think about, and there we get a better shot there of Samoa Joe as Sweet Tooth in Vegas. So basically, what's going on here,
The world is shit, but there are delivery men called milkmen who go and make these deliveries community to community. But during, you know, each delivery, obviously you face hostile situations.
Right.
And they could be delivering anything. You know, the first delivery we see him make, it's like dog food.
Dog food, yeah.
And the people are happy. Are like, yeah, we get to eat tonight, you know. So
and what he's taking is like insulin and medicine and stuff.
And he gets something in return, whatever they can give him. Like, they give him windshield wipers. So he's like, hell yeah, you know, windshield wiper.
He gets that and gas for his car. Uh-huh. He's driving
Apparently, there's plenty of gas in this world.
Yeah.
That's not a problem.
Not like a road warrior type thing, yeah.
Not a road warrior. Even Walking Dead, you know.
Right.
So.
Which is neat, because they're kind of on this bartering system where it's kind of like, hey, you bring us a couple of things, and then we'll take these things and give you these things. So there's, you know, there's a lot of a... It makes a lot of sense. And, you know, so like, again, the show starts with Anthony Mackie doing a delivery, taking some stuff to one place and then taking some stuff to another place. The city he's going to is called New San Francisco. And where we get another one of our primary characters, which is Neve Campbell, who plays the...
she looked great still. I was like, wow.
He did look great. Yeah. In fact, I didn't recognize her. I was like, who's this older woman? She's attractive. And then I was like, oh, shit, that's Neve Campbell.
Yeah, I was like, damn.
Yeah, she's like the... Excuse me, mayor, governor, whatever you want to call it. New San Francisco. So, yeah. So she wants Anthony Mackie to do this job for her, which will gain him entrance into New San Francisco as a permanent insider.
Which apparently that's something he wants.
Yes, yeah, because he's been on the road his whole life. We find out later on. Real quick. Oh, so here we go. Joe says, love Stephanie Beatriz in Brooklyn Nine-Nine. So obviously if she was on that show hugely popular. And then he says, yes, he doesn't know the value of money.
Money doesn't work.
Right. Right. Yeah. And again, too, Anthony Mackie, guys, is so just better in this than he is.
It kind of reminded me of his performance in Pain and Gain.
Okay. A little bit. And I haven't seen that.
Mark Wahlberg. Yeah.
Is he good in that?
Yeah. He's like really funny like this.
Yeah.
Here.
And part of it is this, too, is that, like, you know, since he's always been on the outside, he's kind of aloof. Like, he doesn't know about certain things.
No.
You know? Uh-uh. He goes in, and when Neve Campbell is trying to coax him into...
Like, it went to shit when he was, like, a kid.
Right.
You know? Yeah. So...
And she's trying to coax him to do this job to go to Chicago, which apparently is really dangerous. He mainly travels, I guess, like, on the West Coast.
But that's... You find out there was a reason why she sent him out.
Right.
You know, to see if he can make it back.
Yes.
You know, so, yeah. So, like, yeah, going to Chicago apparently is bad. It's real bad.
Yeah, there's even a funny part. They
won't even come back.
Early on, where, you know, she has them in for a dinner or whatever, and they serve Jell-O, and the guy's like, I'll get dessert, you know, Jell-O or whatever. And he's like, oh, Jell-O? Like, he thinks that Jell-O is something you say when you're getting up to leave the table. So, again, he's very, like, aloof because he doesn't know a lot of things because he's just been living on the outside of these walls all the time. So even though he was a kid, like, when the things fell apart, he didn't, I guess, get to experience a lot of things.
Oh, he didn't.
And there's great music. He's playing CDs. I mean, like, in the very beginning, we hear Cypress Hill.
Yeah.
You know, we hear Oasis. You know what I mean? Like, there's good music throughout the series as well. Joe says, when I saw what the prize was, I was like, what the fuck? Oh, yeah, definitely, Joe. Same here. When you think you're talking about the end, when you get to the end there and you see that.
But it, like I said, it wasn't even really for that. It was just to see... Could he go and come back?
Right.
It was more about
his abilities. Yeah. So there we have, guys, Thomas Hayden Church, Agent Stone, and Neve Campbell again.
She plays Raven.
Raven, yes.
Which my wife was like, you know, usually if there's a woman named Raven, it's not very, she's never a good person.
It's never going to be a good guy. Yeah, no doubt. And, you know, you get shades of what she's up to early on, because she presents her husband and this baby or whatever, and by the end of that episode she's like, all right, get him out of here, like, you know what I mean? So you get like, oh, what's, she's got Anthony Mackie on this mission for what, you know what I mean?
What's he really doing?
Yeah, what's, she's just kind of risking his life. But again, she says, you know, there's been a lot of milkmen in and out of here. She's like, but you're the only one that comes back consistently. So we get that. I think also in the first episode, we do see Quiet and her brother.
Loud. Right? It says here his name is Loud.
Okay,
Loud. And Quiet.
Okay, that's cool.
And yeah, they're fleeing from Stone.
Yes, and they're Latino characters. Mm-hmm. And he tells them that, oh, you're from the OC.
You know, yeah, which he kind of gives like an ominous warning. He's like, oh, OC, you really don't talk, because he sees the, she has like a missing finger. Mm-hmm. He's like, oh, you're OC, you're from OC, you don't talk. And I was like, holy shit, I hope they talk about that soon. I was like,
and they
what
do.
The fuck is that? You know?
And again, Double A, with these short episodes, they dedicate enough of the you get enough background on the things you need to get background on in the 30-minute
episode. That's what I'm saying. It's so good. You got, like, so much information in this first episode in 30 minutes that you're like, man, awesome. I'm hooked to want to watch episode 2.
Totally.
Right? It's like, man, it's like, okay, I feel like I'm getting enough that I can follow this.
This was a very easy show, guys, to just let it ride one to the next one.
That's what I hate with some of the Marvel shows. Mm-hmm. They start so fucking slow.
Yes.
On the introduction.
Yes.
It's like, man, what are you guys doing? Like, get it going a little bit more so that can be more interesting.
I can tell you right now, I enjoyed this thoroughly more than Echo. Like, you know what I mean? And again, as much as I thought that it was a great job to, you know, make her Native American and some of the things we saw in there, it still was not, you know, this show is better. This is a better show. You know what I mean? So I want to ask you real quick, Double A, help me with the titles, because each of the titles.
So guys, I don't know what the first one is supposed to be.
I was curious too. Is it, it's WLUDRV, guys. So each one is kind of done like a license plate, but you know, some of them you can read, you know, because by the time you get to episode 4, it's Who's Dare, WHZDARE, Crossroads is episode 5, Drive Through,
Nut House,
Evelyn, Roadkill,
and Shangri-La.
But the other ones I wasn't really sure about, 1, 2, and 3. Nth Law, and then it's like, so again, guys, the first episode is WLUDRV. I'm not sure what that's supposed to mean. Lud Drive? Would Lud Drive? I don't know. And the second one, the second episode is 3RNCRCS. Not sure about that one. But
the other ones are kind of easier to
kind of decipher what they are. And again, the episode title very much gives you into a little bit of insight of what it's
and
about.
And they're like, they do the titles like their license plates.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and again, like, if you're wondering, like, oh, like, how did he get the car? They talk about that. If you're wondering about Quiet and her brother, they talk about that. If you're wondering about Stone and how he got that way, they talk about that. So in this one season, you know, of 10, 30-minute episodes, so what is that, Double A, 5 hours?
Yeah, 5.
Yeah. It's like, you know, like watching maybe two movies, you get a whole lot. You're like, okay, so you're set up now.
Yes.
We're set up to, in fact, I was even wondering, I was like, okay, well, like, where do they go from here? You know what I mean? Like, there's,
it starts good and it ends very well. Mm-hmm. You're like, wow, I'm really satisfied with this whole season.
Yeah. Yeah. So, give me a little bit your thoughts, Double A, like, you know, episode 1 and what we see happening and where did you kind of think things were going?
So, like I said, I was like, kind of like, okay, I like where this is going. I like how there is a kind of a system. Like, it's cool. There's communities, but there's, like, these deliverers.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, they get fucked with, but they're pretty well-respected, and they get, like, cool shit, you know? It's like, okay, cool. You know, it's a cool barter system
right. That
they have going. And, right. You know, they talk about, you know, kind of a sweet tooth, you know, a little bit. I think they talk about it, right?
I think so, because he goes to get the map, and he's like, to get there, you'll have to go through Vegas. And he's like, you know who runs Vegas?
Yeah.
His map maker friend, we meet him in the first episode as well.
And then you're like, man, you know, when they talk about how, like, Chicago is, you're like, ooh, like, why are you even going there? Like, right. You're like, ooh, man, like, right. You get, like, really, like, you're like, shit, you know, like, I want to see where this is going to happen, like, what's happening over there. I liked it. Like I said, it kept me engaged just enough where I was like, cool, I got a lot of information in the first episode that I want to keep seeing it.
And again, like I told Double A right off the bat, it's fun. And, you know, I'm like, damn, a lot of shows and a lot of shit we watch now is like, it's very serious. It's very heavy. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, there's no room for like laughs. There's no room to kind of like enjoy it, you know, without going to a full on comedy. You know what I mean? I was like, this had great action and a great comedy and then great characters. And like I said, I mean,
and like you said, Neve Campbell, it's like you already knew there was like there's something up with this chick. Yeah. There's, you know, it's up to no good.
Right. And it's not like, you know, a big old misdirection. I mean, you kind of suspect and then it's like, okay, like they're not trying to jerk you around or whatever. No. You know what I mean? It's like, all right, here we go. You know what I mean? But we want you to enjoy the action anyway and these over the top characters. You know, I will say this, Double A, there were times where it felt kind of like, and I think they said it's from the creators of like Deadpool and Zombieland. Yeah. So I was like, if you like that shit, I mean, like there's very much in the vein of that. It even reminded me like some of the over the top shit of like when I would read Preacher comics where I was like, oh, this is just over the top. So by the time we get to episode 2 and we get introduced to Sweet Tooth, I mean, it's like, it's good. And by this time have...
Oh, you know what episode 2 might be? Mm-hmm. It might be Three Ring Circus.
Oh, okay. That's what that one might be. All right.
Now that I'm like thinking about it. Or
yes, that's exactly what it is. Yeah, Three Ring Circus. Hence, you know, Sweet Tooth. So Double A, help me remember, because I thought when he first meets Sweet Tooth at Vegas, he's already with... Quiet.
Yes.
Okay, so she picks her up earlier in the episode.
Well, no, she doesn't. He doesn't really pick her up. She holds him at gunpoint.
Yes, that's
and
right.
And then Sweet Tooth comes at the very end where they're like, shit, they start pointing the guns at Sweet Tooth.
Right.
And then they both get in the car, and it's like, it goes into episode 2 where they're, you know, racing.
Yes.
The fuck out, like, out of his way. Because again, Sweet Tooth apparently has a reputation where, like, everyone seems to know, like, you don't want to go near that area.
Right. And so pretty much, you know, Sweet Tooth is this just like insane fucking clown or whatever, but done in the best possible way. Again, voiced by Will Arnett. The comedy written for the character is hilarious. In fact, I think when he first like starts, you know, beating on Anthony Mackie or whatever, he's like, you know, singing and dancing to Cisco's Thong Song. You know what I mean?
What the fuck?
And Anthony Mackie kind of gets out of it by like singing the lyrics along with him or whatever. And he's like, you like Cisco? You know what I mean? And he's like, oh yeah, man, I always jam out to Drew Hill and all that. And so it's like, they have this funny exchange, but then he's like, oh, okay. Like, you guys want to see my show? You know what I mean? Like, he's excited to have guests and you're like, what the fuck? Like, this guy's like, nuts, but also like,
which, you know, they do kind of show. They show he was in an asylum.
Yeah,
and he has a friend, right? Friend Harold.
Yes, Harold.
That's
the bag,
like a bag,
paper bag. Yeah, and again, that too. If you want to know Sweet Tooth's background, they show you that. So like, all the primary characters get their little story told, and again, it doesn't take away. It doesn't feel like it takes away from like the primary story.
And this episode is going to be all Sweet Tooth, but it's kind of like, they do it and then they're done with this.
Yeah.
They move on.
Yeah.
To the next one.
They don't give you his background now. They'll give that to you later as you kind of get more
invested. But so it's like, we don't stay on Sweet Tooth for episode 2, 3, and 4.
Right.
You know, it's like Sweet Tooth, we stay on his main story for this one. Then he moves on to another community.
Yeah.
That's what I liked. I was like, okay, cool. We're like one and done.
Yeah.
Cool.
And our primary characters moved on too.
Yes.
So in fact, in my mind, I was like, oh, is he going to come back around? Or we only
Which he does. So you will see Sweet Tooth coming out, but it's not going to be like focus heavy on Sweet
Tooth. And you want to see him because he's a character that you're very engaged by right away.
My friend did say who plays Twisted Metal is that's what happens. Is, like, Sweet Tooth just always pops up in the game.
Oh, okay. That's cool. So you don't get to like be Sweet Tooth.
No.
Okay.
I don't think so.
Okay. Cool. So they encounter Sweet Tooth. They manage to get out of Vegas like they're supposed to.
Do see the butchers too in this episode.
Which ones were they?
That group, the butchers that are cutting up humans, that they get humans and they eat them. That's where you see the two buddies, the big dude and his friend. Where they?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
You know,
Stu and the other guy.
Yeah, I forgot his name.
Yeah, they're fucking like seasoning them and they're already like, oh, like they're still alive or whatever. I was like, what the fuck?
It's like a group of cannibals that they call the butchers.
Yes, I forgot about that.
To those two characters too in this episode.
And there's more groups that are out there. Again,
so, Mike and Stu.
Mike and Stu. Yeah, like there's a group called like the Holy Men. Like they'll talk about them and show them later or whatever. Of course, like the Milkmen or the Drivers. I know there's others. I can't think of them right now. Yeah. But take us quick Double A to episode 3.
Pretty much Sweet Tooth gets John and Quiet. He does a whole show for him. Mm-hmm. He gets really pissed because, you know, he's like, he asked them about, you know, what they thought of his show, and he knows that they're bullshitting.
Yeah.
Until Quiet finally speaks, and she goes, it sucked. this whole show sucked. It was boring. You know, Jan, and he starts going, and John Doe, Anthony Mackie starts going at him too. And he's like, oh shit, okay, thanks. You know, thank you for being honest. You're like the first people that are ever honest with me.
Absolutely.
You know? So he's like, cool. So, you know, you get to live.
And just so you guys know, his one-man show, you're thinking he's going to do like a play or some shit, right? He's been watching, I guess, over and over, like the hotel video, like when you get to a hotel and it's like, welcome, blah, blah, the hotel. What? This is where the pool is. This is where this. So he's basically reenacting that. And they're like, no, what the fuck is this? Like, it's horrible, you know? So, yeah, and up to this point, the character Quiet has been, well, quiet. You know what I mean? She hasn't said anything. So she finally speaks in this episode. Also, real quick, double A, we should double back to kind of an integral part of her story, which is what happens to her brother.
Yeah, in so episode he just one. Don't apprehend them. And, you know, because he's punishing them for his bullshit laws that he has going. And he gives them a choice. Either they both die or one of them kills himself. And the brother, you know, commits suicide on his own. On his own rule to save his sister. And so
after that, she has a real, and then he brands Quiet, you know what I mean? Which says,
they brand her on the arm.
Because Stone's whole speech is about, like, oh, like law and order doesn't exist in the outside world anymore, so I'm going to bring back law and order or whatever. So that kind of classic, like, trope of a post apocalyptic world where there's this lawman that wants to bring back the law, whatever. So she immediately gets a hard on for like revenge with, you know, this motherfucker, right? And you know, she's a very resourceful person or whatever. Yes, and again, that's when her and Anthony Mackie cross paths for like the second time, or her and John, and then they, you know, start palling around together to get to a means to an end for each other, so to speak. But yes, go back, go ahead, double A to episode three.
Yeah, so Sweet Tooth, you know, he releases him. He's like, cool. And, you know, he mistakenly thinks that John is telling him to go out into the world, which he's like, yeah, I'll go out into the world. You know, I don't need to be just here. I'll go and
take his show on the road.
Take his show on the road. He's like, wait, that's not what it meant. He's like, no, you're right. I will do it. Thank you very much.
Which is great because now we get to see the ice cream truck. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, he was cruising around in it earlier. Yeah. That's his vehicle of choice. Yeah. You know what I mean? But yeah, it's like, here comes the fucking demented clown in the ice cream truck out in the world now.
Yeah, and then we see Stu and Mike. We find out that they were supposed to be watchmen for their community, but they threw them out because Stu fell asleep.
Mm-hmm.
So they threw both of them out of the community, and then they get captured by the butchers, who are literally human butchers.
Yeah.
You see feet, you see torsos, you see like everything. And like CM said, they're you know, seasoning them up to get eaten. And that's when you see Agent Stone actually saves them.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, and he offers them jobs.
Because he says, oh, you guys were like security here. It's like, we're always looking for new recruits or whatever. And so he enlists them. For them, it's like better than death.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Oh, yeah.
They take the gig, and we do get to see a little bit of where he's kind of like testing them out, right?
Yes.
Like, okay,
yes,
you know, are you able to kill and all that?
Yeah,
we see that Stu kind of isn't, you know what I mean? He's not ready
he's
to
not
just
that kind of
be
guy.
A cold blooded killer.
Where Mikey's like, fuck it, you know, shit.
Yeah, he's one of these classic guys. It's like, oh, well, you know, this is like our meal ticket now, so we should stick with it.
Yeah, because they saw they're protected, they got food,
right?
You know, and they get more rewarded as it, you know, the better they do,
yeah. Yeah, but, you know, again, Stu just didn't seem to have that hard heart to kill.
He's not,
you know what
he's
I mean?
Not a killer.
Right. He reminded me a little bit of, like, Stingray's character from Cobra Kai.
Yes.
Like, you know, they're kind of like, you know, big dummy, you know what I mean? But, like, maybe good-hearted, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, definitely loyal. I would say loyalty would be a quality of his, for sure. What else goes on in this episode? Is there anything else? Do we see? I think we do see more of John and Quiet.
So they, after all that, they go up to finally where Agent Stone is, and then that's where they get stunned and they get captured by Agent Stone.
Right.
And that kind of ends that. But we had like almost like two sections on this episode.
Yeah,
where we get introduced to Stu and Mike, Sweet Tooth, and you know, more of Agent Stone.
Right.
And his community.
Right. Then do we go to episode four? And again, guys, we're going quick because it's quick.
It's three.
Oh, three.
And this is like Agent. This is like Agent Stone's episode.
Okay.
This is where, you know, we find out, you know, what's what's he been doing and what he's planning on doing.
Right.
You know, building a whole blockade.
Yes.
Pretty much across America.
Yes.
And doing the, you know, the license shit and apprehending people and all that bullshit.
Yeah, making people get like a road license. Yes. I think even at one point, Quiet's like, oh shit, it's the fucking DMV. Like, he's bringing back like the DMV. Yeah. Like, there's paperwork again and like all this shit. And people are like, what the fuck? You know what I mean? So, and I think his base is like at, where's he at? The Grand Canyon?
Hoover Dam.
Hoover Dam. That's where he's at. Is that near the Grand Canyon? Let me see. Where the fuck is that? I don't know. Get me, somebody help my geography here be off sometimes.
It's, let me see. In the Black Canyon of the Colorado River on the border between Nevada and Arizona.
Okay. Well, yeah, Arizona. That's, you know.
So yeah, they're making their way. It's like you said, they're making their way from New San Francisco through, you know, to Chicago. So that's how they're going.
Yeah, and Quiet basically, you know, she's telling, you know, John, you know, Anthony Mackie as character, you know, like, give me a lift just so far or whatever. You know what I mean? So
and then you know, they find the map and they're like, what the hell is this? It's like, this map avoids all my blockades. You know? Who made this for you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they torture them by making them fill out paperwork and blasting like loud music on and, you know, all this kind of shit. You know, it's stupid. It's like, it's really stupid.
It is. They do waterboard them at one point or whatever, but yeah, there's a lot of also stupid tortures as well. But again, it adds to the hilarity of the show. It adds to the, you know, I want to say like kind of like the attitude the show is giving you, whatever, where it's like, you know, there's, you know, horrible shit going on. It's post-apocalyptic, but it's also funny again, you know. Again, like, I can't get over the tagline I read, which was, like, making the apocalypse fun again. again, very much like that Zombieland and vibe.
I'm going to say maybe this one's supposed to be Not the Law.
Okay.
Maybe.
Okay.
Maybe that's what this one is.
Maybe you're right. That could be what that one is. Yeah. Not the Law. All right. All right. What else happens here, AA, in this one?
I think she does kill Stealth's number two guy.
Yes,
she catches him like jerking off.
Yeah,
anime.
Yeah,
you know, an anime book.
And she pistol whips him, I think.
Yeah, she does. You know, makes the apocalypse fun.
Joe got it right there, exactly.
Yeah, eventually they get out because Stu, you know, they start appealing to Stu. Stu, you know, lets him escape, and
again, he's like your lovable loser type guy, you know. So and they mean to take him with them, but dumb luck, he doesn't get taken with
them. The trunk pops open. There's something apparently with his trunk that you can't just like pop it open. It'll pop open on its own and it fucking knocks him out.
Yeah, it hits him and then it's like, you know what I like too is that there wasn't like a moment where they're like, oh, we gotta go back. They were kind of like, well, fuck it. You know what I mean? Like, gotta keep going. just keep going.
And then she finds out that Stone went to Topeka. So that's where she wants to go.
That's where she wants to go next. Yeah, and she's not telling Anthony Mackie's outright.
Her thing is revenge.
Right.
That's all she's thinking. Revenge against Agent Stone.
For her brother, who she blames for that. Is this where we see Sweet Tooth show up at that base? Totally or not yet? Not till the next one.
I think it's the next one.
Okay. So going right into that next one, AA, is that Who's There?
Who's There.
Okay, episode 4. We're at episode 4 now. Yeah.
And then that's when you get the ladies, the ones who are running the trucks.
Yes.
The big rigs. That's how they travel.
What'd you think about this group?
I like them.
It was very cool.
I like how you said that apparently they get their fuel from waste, human waste.
Yeah.
I think I've heard something about that before.
That's very interesting. Yeah.
How are you guys able to, like, just, because, like, they live, like, totally on the road.
On the road.
It's, like, 24-7. They're just, that's all they're doing.
Driving.
It's driving, and they're, like, human waste.
Yeah, which is, like, okay, that'd be, like, a pretty viable fuel source if you could get it working, yeah. Some grandma is, like, the leader.
Yeah, granny, but she's dying, and they want hire her to do a job to go get some flowers from an ex-associate of theirs, which we find out is like the girlfriend of like the number two.
The number two.
Here.
Right. Yeah. And also there's, he's got so his Watts, car, his car's kind of fucked up.
The blonde haired chick is Watts.
Watts.
And they went to go see Amber, her ex-lover.
Yes. Yes. And John's car needs some repairs too. And they offer him that, right?
They're like, because they take his guns.
They strip his car when Stone has it. Yeah.
But they're like, we can give you all the guns back, everything. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll weld it so it's like right back to you together.
Yeah. And John loves his car, you know, Evelyn or whatever. You know what I mean? We find out why, like, the relationship is so special. I mean, obviously that's his mode of transportation and also kind of what keeps him alive in the apocalypse, but there's more to it than that. And so, you know, he's like willing to make this deal to go to this dangerous run on side of his run he's already doing because he wants to get his car decked back
up. Now, I think this is the first episode where we get the mention of the Holy Man, maybe?
I think so. Yeah.
And you hear the bells and you're just like, oh man, holy man, that just doesn't sound good.
Yeah.
You know?
And I think we even get a shot of a guy on a cross upside down or yes. whatever, like hanging. Yes. So you're kind of like, what the fuck's going on with there? Joe brings up a good point here. He says, dude, the shit Amber does with the herbs is crazy.
Which I told my wife, I go, man, this is like poison ivy. Like,
absolutely.
Knowing the plants. I'm like, that's awesome.
Yeah. They show up, you know, to her house and she offers them some sweet tea right away.
And real quick, Joe says, Granny, I believe, is a character in one of the games.
Oh, is that right? Nice. Okay. Okay, yeah, cool. So, okay. I did not know that. That's pretty badass that they were like including more people from the games. So very cool.
The last comment he says, Preacher.
Yes. Yeah. Who's played by Jason Mantzoukas.
Oh, is that who it is?
Okay. Yeah. And if you know Jason Mantzoukas, he's the voice of Rexplode.
Okay.
But he's also a very excellent podcaster who does a show that's called How Did This Get Made?
Oh, okay.
He's hilarious on that with Paul Scheer. And Paul Scheer's wife, but I also know him from the League as Rafi on the League, and he's hilarious in that too. Jason and also one of the voices from Big Mouth. So Jason Mantzoukas has a pretty extensive volume of work himself, and all of it is fucking hilarious. So I love any chance I get to see Jason Mantzoukas in something else, and him being the preacher was excellent. We'll get to that episode for sure, Joe.
And he says he was also in Brooklyn Nine-Nine, too.
Wow. That's one that I haven't watched, but I keep hearing more things, especially with Andre Brower passing. I know that people
have been watching. Is he from What We Do?
Who? Jason Mantzoukas?
The Preacher?
Did he come out in that one? I don't know if he did come out in What We Do in the chest. He might have, now that I think about it. I have to go back and look.
Vampire that has that club?
No. That's the,
Okay.
He comes out in Big Mouth also. Them two are in Big Mouth together, and they were in the lead together. That's Nick Kroll.
Okay.
Nick Kroll is that vampire. Yes, yeah.
Yeah, so they go see Amber, and you know, after she poisons both of them, they're like, wait, you know, we're just trying to, you know, we're just trying to get this list from Granny. And she's like, Granny? And then she sees the list, and she's like, oh, shit. And then she gives them flowers to kind of counteract the drug that she just gave them.
Because they're pretty much fucking paralyzed, right?
I was like, whoa. Like, the fucking shit you can do if you know your plants. Like, wow.
And again, she's such a, like, a mousy-looking, like, yes, cute girl. That you're like, oh, she offered them sweet tea. She's like...
But she protects herself. That's how she kind of protects herself from... She says the Holy Man.
Yeah.
So they've been after her a few times.
And she knows what to do. Absolutely, yeah. D mentions that Jason Mantzoukas also comes out in Parks and Rec. Man, I don't remember him coming out in there. I have to probably go back and rewatch those eps for sure. Joe says, him and Stephanie Beatriz were a couple in Brooklyn Nine-Nine. Okay, interesting. All right. Is he a cop also in that? I'm curious to see him play that kind of role. He says, Zooks is in John Wick, Mantzoukas is in John Wick 3. Damn, I need to rewatch John Wick. That guy's been busy. Shit. He's been busy, yeah. He says, Dante Fierro, a.k.a. Dennis Feinstein. Okay. It's been a while since I had a Parks rewatch, so I got to check it out. He says, they didn't just touch the herb and get paralyzed. Yeah. I don't remember. I thought it was them drinking the tea,
She touches him. Mm-hmm. She rubs, like, the plant on him.
Oh, yeah, to get better.
That's how.
Right. Yes, yeah.
I think.
Which is awesome. And then her little house is like beautiful where she's at. She's got a nice little setup out there. Good stuff though, guys. Thank you for the info.
So they get it, you know, she's like, okay, here you go. You know, you're good to go. These are exactly what she wants, you know, so.
And also too, we find out there's a little bit of a love story between her and Watts and, you know, kind of like, you know, they kind of, you know, again, it's very tongue in cheek in the fact that they're all like, oh, you know, maybe you should like, you know, talk it out with her, blah, blah. So that goes on as well. We're still in the same episode though, right?
Yes, and then that's when they get chased by the Holy Man, right?
Yes.
Holy Man. And they go to the movie theater. He puts on a movie. Do you remember what movie it was? I can't remember the damn movie now.
It was something I knew too. And she's telling him, I think, you've never seen this before? Someone's gonna tell us, watch. I know, I can't remember what movie it was. Was it an 80s flick?
There was something. Man, I can't remember for life. I can't remember what movie it was.
Yeah.
What they do, they fall asleep. He washes her jacket. She gets pissed off because the brother's blood was still
right,
on there.
Right.
Now she's like, I don't have nothing of him.
Which you even know? Like, remember when fucking he blows his brains out? Stone's like, well, that's a lot of brains. Who would have thought? I was like, fuck.
No share. They make up. They go to the truck. You know, apparently Granny's taking that to just die quicker.
Okay.
She's gonna die, but it's not gonna be painful.
Yeah.
So she dies quicker. Her pain, yeah. They give him Evelyn. You know, it's all souped up, brand new.
Yeah,
you know?
They even load like a fucking rocket on the top, which is pretty badass. Yeah. You know,
They sent Granny too. Like, she dies in the car, they let it go, and then they blow it up.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, shit.
Like, they were like, oh, it's a pretty, like, at first, Quiet and John are like, oh, it's a pretty, like, you know, like, lackluster, like, ending. You know what I mean? They just let her roll out in a car, and they fucking blow it up, and they're like,
thank you,
okay,
Joe.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Blank man. Yes, that's right. And they're doing the voices. They're doing the voices. That's right. Yes, Joe Goodwood. Joe also says, he says, bro, in Brooklyn Nine-Nine, he's a cop. I'm referring to Jason Mantzoukas. He says he comes off 7 years undercover. He's wild.
Oh, shit.
I could see him. You know, he has that look, right?
Yes.
The, with the hair and the, you know, the grayish hair and the beard and the way he sounds, too. You know, I'd like to know what his nationality is. If anybody can look that up and tell me, I'm curious what Jason Mantzoukas is what his ethnic background is, because it's very ambiguous from what I can see. But yeah, like, I'm like, is he Latino? Is he, you know, what is he? go ahead, Dolan.
So we go to episode 5. That's it. So again, it's kind of like shit. Episode 1, we get the introduction.
Mm-hmm.
2, we get to see Sweet Tooth. 3, we see Agent Stone. And then 4, we see this trucking kind of community, right?
Yes.
So it's kind of like, man, it's just like boom, boom, boom. It's kind of like that's what's cool about it. We don't stay very long on any of these, but we meet a whole great cast of characters along
absolutely.
The way.
Yeah, you get to meet Watts, you know what I mean? You get to meet the grandma, you know, you get to meet Amber.
Agent
Stone,
right. Shepherd, Mike Stu.
We hear word of the holy men. So it's like, again, the pace, it's really just perfect pacing is really
it
what
really
it is.
It's just one and done. Boom, 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 boom. Okay, cool. We're moving on still.
Like, no minutes are wasted. You know what I mean? They're like, oh, okay, cool. Like you have no trouble following it.
You feel like you get like a good amount though.
Yeah.
In each episode.
And what it does especially well is that you're left at the end of one episode to be like, I want to stick to the next one. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, even if I'm like, let me just watch 5-10 minutes of the next one. You know what I mean? So, and I'm like, that's what TV's supposed to do. Yeah. That's what it's supposed to be doing. Like, why is this missing from everywhere?
I don't know.
And guys, go back our last 3, 4, 5 episodes. Me and this guy have been saying, we're like, man, like 30-minute television is gone. Telling a story fast is gone. People can't do it no more. And I'm like, nope, there are still people that can do it, and they're doing it very well. So well done without there. Real quick, Joe's saying, Blank Man, he says they're watching it without sound. And regarding Mantzoukas' background, Greek, obviously, Mantzoukas. I should have thought, duh, Greek. Yeah, so, okay, and you know, again, he could easily play like an Arab guy or anything like that. You know, I mean, just saying that his look
Greek. Can
potentially Greek, yeah.
Okay.
Makes sense, Mantzoukas. That sounds Greek.
Okay.
You know,
no shit, right?
He says you start to see them putting weapons on the car, like in the game. Okay, okay, cool. That's neat, too. Again, as in having not played the game, us, I mean, that's neat that you can soup up your
like, PlayStation was never, like, my area, like, at all. Like, I remember PS1 kind of not being that great of a system.
Yeah.
You know, 64 killed PS1. It wasn't until PS2 came out that apparently that's the one that just blew everybody away. But I never, by that point, I was way out of the games.
Right. And it's funny for me because like I played a lot of 64 with your brother, but he was the only one I knew that had it. Everyone else I knew had a PlayStation.
Well, man, PlayStation, I remember the whole thing with PlayStation was like the loading time. Remember?
I do remember that. The
forever.
Loading. Yeah. But boy, we played games like Battle Arena Toshinden, the first Resident Evil, the first Tomb Raider.
I mean, hey, though, 64 just looked better, though, than PlayStation 1.
You know, I have that the one they did, the little mini one that's got like several games loaded. I mean, like, I don't know. I liked it. Maybe the graphics were better
than 64. Bad, yeah. Things, I think 64 kind of kicked
a little
ass.
Bit smoother. Oh,
yeah.
Oh, like
until PS2 came out, and then PS2 is the one that just became the lead.
Right after that, for sure. Real quick here, was there new comments? Oh, here we go. Joe says,
it was made during COVID restrictions, which is why you didn't see huge crowds.
Oh, okay. That makes sense. And that actually kind of worked in its favor because it made it seem more like post-apocalyptic.
Then Joe says, I had a freaking Dreamcast for a while.
Yeah, Marquis said
that was Sega, right?
Yeah, Sega's attempt. Yeah, I do remember playing a little bit on that. I can't remember what I played on that, but yeah. In fact, I got him an ornament for Christmas of the Dreamcast. It actually turns on. It makes like it has like a little Sonic that comes out. Cool. Yeah, it was pretty cool. Joe says 64 dominated with the multiplayer. Yeah, that's what really I think helped them, was to have them four ports, Bond, the GoldenEye game, obviously the Mario game, you know. He said PlayStation brand had these brand specific games like this game. Okay, so Twisted Metal was exclusive, I think, to PlayStation.
But even Nintendo, it was still like Mario.
They had Mario and Zelda. They've always had those. Yeah. Right, yeah. Right. So getting back into it, guys, again, we're already halfway through.
Poisons John with the drink, it just knocks him out. But then there's like these things called vultures or whatever.
Yes. And they just pick off like whatever I guess they find, right? That's kind of their whole thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And he kills one of them, right? He kills that one. It's like
That dirty old man or whatever, right?
Then they show Sweet Tooth. Sweet Tooth is actually he gets one of the outposts and Stone has and kills a shitload of people.
Yes.
And he's like, man, you know, this felt good to kind of just like kill all these people. And Stu is like, well, there's a whole bunch more of these compounds you want to, you know, that we can do this to. And he's like, all right, let's go. And he gets like a whole following, a whole group of followers to go with it.
These are my fans, you know what I mean? So that's really cool, too, because at this point, I think Stu was kind of, like, going to get fucking killed because he fucked up losing the two, prisoners, John and Quiet. But, you know, Sweet Tooth's arrival changes all that. And how about those deaths, Double A, with the fucking machete are, like, it's graphic. Guys, I mean, like, again, too, this is a Peacock show, a Peacock original. But if you were expecting it to be, like, PG-13 or something, it is not. I mean, it is, like, there's blood, there's gore, there's cussing. You know, there's sex. I think there's titties. Is there titties?
Yeah, I believe so.
I think there might be titties. So, you know, normally I don't forget, but in this instance, perhaps. I've been watching, like, a lot of shit, and I've been like, is there titties in that? There's been, like, because I was wondering if there was titties in that Loudermilk, and there is.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, there is tits. Because he goes in that strip club, and every time someone goes to a strip club in a show or something, I, like, look around, right? I'm like, okay. And most of the time, the girls are, like, in bikinis or whatever. And I was like, oh, no, that girl is. And even I think he was like, oh, okay. Like, yeah, he's like, that's nice, you know what I mean? let's see here real quick. Joe says, can't forget the wrestling games. Absolutely not. We had a blast playing those. Even the WCW games were incredible.
Yeah,
those are fun. But Attitude, what was the other one? I think that WrestleMania 2000 was on that one also, too. WWE got two games. They had great times on those. Joe says, I like that people actually died. Yes, agree. Like, there was no, like, you know, people not fucking dying in this show. Like, fucking Sweet Tooth went fucking to town on these motherfuckers.
Yeah, and then the second part of this episode is like Quiet kind of going to one of his main bases.
Yes.
And being discovered by his officers. John comes at the end of this episode, saves her from all that. So
absolutely. Yeah. This is where they see the statue of his ass, right?
Yes. Yes.
And he's kind of trying to convince her, like, a little bit, like, it's not really worth it or whatever, you know. And I think this is the point too where she starts to get the visions of her brother. Yes. Uh-huh. And her brother's pretty much like, man, like, you're stupid or whatever. Like, I gave my life so you could live, and here you are trying to throw yours away. So she's having a little bit of an inner monologue, you know, through her brother's voice about, like, you know, this is fucking dumb, this whole revenge shtick or whatever, you know. So All good shit, though, whatever. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, I felt, too, like, it got to that quick. Like, it didn't, like, I didn't have to, it wasn't drawn out, her getting to Stone, you know? So, go ahead, Double A.
So, the next episode, they're at a restaurant where they get, what kind of storm is it?
I forget what he calls it, a well storm?
Some shit like that, yeah. So, you kind of have to be inside when the storm hits.
Yeah.
And they go inside this restaurant where you kind of start, You find out what the OC, the whole thing with the OC is. Yeah. You find out a little bit about Quiet's past. And I think even you find out a little bit about John in this one.
Yeah. So it's really weird because that OC, you know, Orange County, I guess, is like where, like, they literally were like picking fruit, her and her brother. Yes. You know what I mean? Like, you know, they're obviously like Latino and they're picking fruit. But I guess they find out, like, hey, there's a way we can, like, get our own land if we
go work. Yeah, so it says that they worked picking oranges and Quiet got them a contract to work for 4 years of indentured servitude and a human settlement in exchange for beachfront property.
Right. But the fucked up part is that, like, these people or whatever there, they can, like, you're pretty much saying, like, you're going to be a slave, you know what I mean?
For, they're abused, they get amputations for punishment. Her middle finger was removed by her master and worn as a necklace.
Yeah, and even the people that are like working at this fast food restaurant or whatever are wearing like necklaces of ears or whatever. Like, I guess they all have servants or whatever, which is like fucked up, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I was like, who the fuck would agree to this? Like, this shit sounds awful, especially if they have the right to do that. Yeah, it's pretty bad.
There's like a shootout. One of them says, you know, it's all bullshit. This whole contract's bullshit.
Right.
You're not going to get any contracts. You're not going to get any land.
Yeah.
He gets shot. Loud, you know, the brother kind of, you know, does some shit. He gets punished. He gets his ear cut off.
Mm-hmm.
But then everyone's killed by Quiet, you know. So she comes back and she kills them.
And saves the brother.
Yeah.
And so, and throughout we see the kind of the jacket that she's wearing. It comes into play, you know, throughout. That was her brother's jacket, and she's wearing it, you know, throughout.
In this episode too, they have sex too.
Yeah, like you, two finally, or three times. Yeah. Which, like, I guess you kind of grasped that there was sexual tension, but even if it hadn't have gone that way, like, it still was fine. I mean, like, it's just kind of like, oh, okay, I guess they're gonna hook up. You know what I mean? Yeah, and it's kind of like, I guess, like a McDonald's, like a Burger King or something. So they're fucking in like the ball pit or whatever, you know. And again, too, there's so many aspects about Anthony Mackie's character. You know, it's almost like he's childlike in a way. So you're kind of like, what the fuck? You know, but it's like, obviously he's a man because he's like knows about hooking up. What did you think too about like his physique in this AA? Like, you know, Joe was saying it was shot during COVID, which makes me wonder, whatever. He's not in, like, Captain America shape. No. He's a little doughy.
It might have been, maybe they asked for him to do that.
Maybe so, because they show him without a shirt a couple of times, and it's like, and at one point, you know, she's admiring his back, right? And it's like, I'm thinking to myself, like, oh, you're thinking it's going to be one of those classic scenes where he's looking ripped, right? And I was like, dang, Anthony Mackie looking a little flabby up in this shit. I was like, all right, man. Which was kind of cool to me, because it was like, oh, he's like an everyman.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
yeah.
It was a very... And I noticed they didn't really focus on his friendship, but maybe he was kind of like, damn, I ain't really in shape. You know what I mean? Like, he definitely was not in, like, you know, no Chris Evans, Chris Hemsworth. Like,
even Pain and Gain, where he looks pretty big.
Is he big in that one? Yeah. Like, Jack, yeah, I was like, and I don't even think they show him that much in Falcon and Winter Soldier, like, being jacked. But he did not look jacked in this. I was like, he looked a little bit like my man had been eating good, you know what I'm saying? So, in this shot real quick is Mike, there's Quiet, Stu, and it's Mike, right?
Mike and Stu.
And then we got... John again, right there, John Doe. I like his high C shirt.
Stupid shirt.
another look at them here, and then we're gonna get to we talked about him earlier, but Jason Mantzoukas as the preacher character, which we'll talk to about more when we get to that episode here. But go ahead, double.
Yeah, we're in episode 7, Nut House. This is finally where we get kind of Sweet Tooth background.
Yeah.
So we get that. We get to where he gets to New Chicago. And then we meet, we have the Milkman's stop.
Oh, yes, the bar. Yes, that part was cool too, yeah.
What did you think of Sweet Tooth's story?
I didn't see that coming. I was kind of like, okay, he's this child actor.
But you're like, the show he was called, I guess, was called Three Scoops, and then it's called, like, what was the... Billy
and Three Scoops? Billy and Three Scoops? Or Rusty or some shit.
And you're like thinking, okay, maybe it's like, a brother or like another actor, and he
almost like an Urkel type character, maybe it's like stealing the show.
Yeah, and then you find out it's a fucking dog. Like, the dog's like super popular.
Yeah.
And he has a mom and his stepfather, which the stepfather is like, you know, you go out there, he's kind of like a dick stepfather.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're pretty much telling him like just do it
just
or whatever.
Do
like,
it.
You know, he's like the moneymaker, the meal ticket or whatever. Well, he decides he doesn't like that too much. AA, so
he performs, and the dog comes out and gets like a big old response, and he's like, eh, like he just snaps.
Yeah, and what does he grab? He grabs something to use.
What does he grab?
This isn't like a pencil or something.
The grandma was like doing the sewing, so he had the sewing needles.
Fuck. Yeah, and this does happen off camera. Now, I'm one for violence and gore and all that, but I was like, well, I didn't want to see the dog get that or whatever. And you don't see it,
but
you hear it.
Yeah.
And, so pretty much he takes care of his co-star right then and there to the crowd, the audience's dismay as well. I think that pretty much ends him up in the psych ward.
They send him here and there, and he ends up in the silo, you know. But then we
see Harold here too, right? The bag. Yeah. Like I don't know how he's involved in that point or whatever. But yeah, his best friend is this fucking just a brown paper bag. So you're like, That guy's clearly fucking
nuts. Yeah, so he takes Stu through a little walkthrough through the asylum, and that's where you find out that when everything hit the fan, shit hit the fan, he came back for his mom and stepfather.
Yeah.
He locked them up in the cell.
And they're just there rotted or whatever. Yeah. You know, he's like, oh, here's mom and dad. You know what I mean? I was like, fuck. No, he says mom and whatever. He's like, I'm still not going to call you dad.
I'm still not going to call you dad. You know what I'm
saying? And again, it's so perfect because, you know, you have, you know, Samoa Joe, whatever, obviously this very physical, you know, wrestler or whatever, you know, doing the body work, but it's all very good, like his motions and his gestures and, you know, even his, like, you know, the way he is, like, you can see yourself being uncomfortable around him. Yeah. You know? How big is Joe, though?
Joe's got to be like 6'2", 6'3".
Okay, because I remember when I met him, I was like, this guy's fucking, he looks a lot bigger.
He's got to be, because Punk's like about 6'2", I believe.
And when I met Punk in person, he was sitting down. So yeah. I didn't get a real vibe for how big he was or whatever. Yeah. But when I met Joe, he was standing up and he did lean over. Like, our picture is kind of like he's leaned over or whatever. And I was like, hey, he's fucking like a lot bigger than me. Yeah. Like, he looked way bigger than Finn, and I was there with Finn, too. And I was like, oh, shit, this fucking guy's pretty big. But yeah, so that story goes really,
it's really cool. Yeah, that's episode 7. Check it out. That whole kind of story is really cool. John and Quiet get to New Chicago. They get the package from Calypso, so they're like really excited. He's like, cool, we can go back. He's like, you know, there's this bar we can stop where it's just like a milkman bar. We can stop there, right. We can kind of get supplies and everything, and we can make our way back. It'll be
fuel
fine.
Up and all that stuff. Yeah, real quick, Joe says the backstory was nuts for Sweet Tooth. Yeah, absolutely agree. I was like, fuck, not the dog. I was like, you know. But yeah, so they get to stop right away. I think Quiet meets, she gets fucked with getting the gas.
And then Mary comes in, you know, they find out that's John's, like, ex-chick or whatever.
Now I wonder, and maybe Joe you can answer this or anyone else out there still listening, but was Mary a character from the games as well? I got the impression that maybe like her, Watts, you know, I know Joe mentioned the grandma, obviously Sweet Tooth were characters from the game, but I did a little bit of research on the game, but I didn't see some of the characters from the show that I recognized, so I was just curious if maybe they were in other versions of the game, you know what I mean? But she definitely felt like a character.
There's like a whole shitload of these games
apparently. I kind of felt like the way, like, people that had like a name like she did were like, well, they possibly I might have been a character. Quiet's trying to get gas, some guy cuts her off, some fucking scruffy dude, he's a dick or whatever, and before Quiet can kind of like fuck him up or whatever, this chick Mary intervenes, this blonde chick, and takes care of business, and they seem to be becoming friendly as they walk into the bar, and then she's like, oh, well, who are you here with? And she's like, oh, I came with, and before she can answer, Mary sees John and like runs up, jumps on him, and like fucking kisses him or whatever. And it was cool too, because I like that, like, immediately she wasn't like a jealous type or whatever. Quiet, she just seemed kind of like, oh, okay,
yeah.
And she even tells him when she's like, what, you had a past? Like, duh, like, you know, the world's been broken for a while or whatever, you know. So they, you know, they seem to be having good about it, you know.
So yeah, they're throughout the night they're drinking, and then John accidentally tells Mary, you know, he's got this sweet gig where if he delivers this, he gets a home.
Yeah.
And she's like, what? And he's like, no, you know, I forget what I just said. I'm drunk. You know, blah, blah, blah. She tells everybody.
Every other milkman in the place. Or whatever. And I like, too, the fact that his plan is like, let's get them drunk and we can find out, like, you know, more info on, like, runs and stuff like that. Yeah. And they're drinking fucking buttery nipples, so, like, the girliest drink, whatever, right? And then he ends up getting all fucked up, you know?
And that just goes to shit. It becomes, like, a big old fight.
Yeah, big old brawl in there,
They kill a lot of people in there.
Yeah. And earlier, too, I think Mary and Quiet have this exchange because she takes a shower and Mary's kind of watching. Yeah. And you know, they talk and they kind of talk about John or whatever. And, you know, what impression did you get there, Double A? Did you get the impression that Mary still, like, had feelings for him? You know what I mean? So, and
she got mad that she was driving. She got mad that, you know, he was riding with someone.
Yeah.
You know, she got
pissed. She could tell that her and John and Quiet had fucked in the car because she had the steering wheel impression on her lower back. And she's obviously, like, checking her out while she showers or whatever, which in itself was kind of hot. But I was like, all right. I think she tells her, she's like, man, I wish I had areolas like that. And I was like, dang, all right. But, yeah, so I'm like, all right, you know, fucking John.
But you're thinking, you know, they're in the all same line of work, you know, they're not gonna fuck each other, but right. Yeah, it all goes to shit.
And she's kind of trying to make Quiet feel like, oh, well, you know, you're just like another plaything to him or whatever. You're nothing. Like, of course, trying to upset the balance that they got going on, but you know, just like kind of classic, you know, again, too, the show doesn't shy away from using like tropes. It's like, oh yeah, you know, that's what we're going to go with, the jealousy trip right here. And it's like, okay, it's fine. It's not like it's like a deep part of the story. It's just very surface level, yeah, which doesn't need any more than that.
No, it really doesn't.
So, go ahead, tell me what happens next here. Joe, real quick.
Barroom scene had a lot of characters.
Oh, okay, cool. All right, that's awesome. See, I need to watch probably like a video on YouTube, that, and I didn't do this before because I didn't want to, you know, ruin it, the experience of talking about it with Double A and you guys. But I'll probably look for a video like that on YouTube afterwards, like the comparisons, because there's always, someone always inadvertently does a video like that and shows you all the Easter eggs.
Yeah,
you
know? I'm sure he did.
Then he also says, when Quiet kills her... yeah, she's like, this is hot. Is this hot? And she's like, yeah, it is kind of hot, yeah. Go ahead, Double A, sorry.
You know, they escape, and then they say Song gets a message about where their destination is. So.
Right, right. Yeah. And in the meantime, has he also gotten word yet, or he hasn't gotten word yet, that Sweet Tooth is going from place to place to
his place? He already has.
Fucking tearing him up or whatever, which is awesome. Yeah. Uh-huh. And at the same time, he's also garnering more to his... kind of his cause, or as he says, his audience, whatever. So this is just his legend is in a sense growing there. You know what I mean? Yeah. Where are we at this point? Are we on 7, 8 yet?
8 is Evelyn. Okay. So we get the whole backstory with John.
Mm-hmm.
We get how he has amnesia, how he got the amnesia. We find out about his family. We find out how he came about Evelyn. We get introduced to the Holy Man in this episode. It's a lot for, like, again, how we said
30 minutes. Yeah.
It's fucking a lot. Packed in this episode.
Yeah. And yet, again, too, it doesn't feel rushed. It doesn't feel like...
It really doesn't.
You know how sometimes we feel like, I think we're just feel like they're trying to cram too much in. It doesn't feel like that. It's like, it's good pacing. It's just enough. Yes. Like, again, I think what they do is that they give you, like... It's kind of like they're letting a little bit of robot at a time, and it feels like they're not going to give you too much where you're going to ask a lot of questions. You're like, oh, okay, I understand that now, and then they reel it back in, and they're like, okay, back to the main story here. Joe says, she had a little too much of Rob Zombie's chick vibe. Oh, okay. Regarding Mary.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. All right. I could definitely see all that. Right. He says, wait, did y'all just pass up the dude with the watermelon? Oh yeah.
The big dick dude.
Dr. Slam or whatever it was, or what's your name?
I think I forgot his fucking Slam. Name. Was the guy with the big dick that can fucking
quiet
destroy the watermelon.
He's the bartender at the Milkman bar. And yeah, good call, Joe.
And it's funny because like Anthony Mackie actually wants to see it, you know, before all the shit goes down. He's like, man, she could have waited another minute, you know?
Because he's got this watermelon on. I think it's almost like a fucking Gallagher, but with his fucking dick or whatever. And like, they kind of show it, you know, very love sausages. You can fucking see it through his pants or whatever, a fucking huge ass cock or whatever. And earlier when he meets Quiet, she's like, what's your nickname? And he says, Dr. Slam or whatever, I think, or Mr. Slam, something like that.
Yeah.
And she's like, why do they call you that? And he's like, well, because I can smash anything with my dick or whatever. And she's like, okay, you know what I mean? So apparently he puts on a show every night at the fucking bar or whatever. And it's right about to happen or whatever until after they kill everyone. And then I think they're like, wait, like, show us, you know what I mean? It's like, he fucking smashes the watermelon with his cock.
John wants to see it too.
Yeah. I mean, you got to say that's fucking something you just don't see every day. So, again, a testament to the over-the-topness of this show, where you definitely get that Deadpool producers are involved and Zombieland producers. Yeah. I wouldn't doubt that anybody, maybe they even worked on the Preacher show, might have been involved in this. But yeah, you know, we see how John finds Evelyn. You know what I mean? Pretty much the car kind of saves his life because he ends up finding food in there, finding money in there that he... burns to make a fire, finding, I think, a weapon in there.
Yeah.
You know, so it's kind of like, damn, you know, you're in this really bad situation. You're a kid. And then, like, all of a sudden, this thing gives you all the things you need. And one of the things, I guess, if there was one thing I didn't like, if somebody were to say, well, what's one thing you didn't like? I didn't like how he didn't explain this to Quiet, like, about Evelyn, like, when they had that fight later on. I would have said, look, you know, when I was a kid and alone and afraid and didn't have anything or anyone in the world, I had this car. You know what I mean? Like, this is why it means so much to me. You know what I mean? Like, he didn't ever really, I think, like, explain that to her. You know what I mean? When I would have been like, a lot of times I feel like sometimes in shows, people don't do the simple thing of explaining a little bit. You know what I mean? And I'm like, well, I guess maybe if they did that,
plot
wouldn't move along. But, you know, I thought it was a simple explanation. And again, for this type of show where they didn't seem to try to go too deep, I was like, oh, that would have been a very simple, like, way to get out of their little argument or whatever, you know. But go ahead, Double A.
Yeah. So all that's going on, they get captured by the Holy Man. He fights the preacher. We meet. Had to leave. He loses. She finds a way to escape, but he's like, no, I can't leave Evelyn. She gets really mad because she's like, really? It's just a fucking car. You know, yeah. And he's like, I can't leave Evelyn.
Well, and let's talk about real quick, about Preacher, right? Because he doesn't want to just drive the car. You know, he's like, man, I want to
ready to fuck.
Yeah, he's like, I want to lube up and like fuck your muffler or whatever the car. Like, he's like really turned on because they bring him like a bunch of other shit too, right? Like,
he's like drugs.
Drugs. Guns, he's like more drugs. You know, he's like, nah. He's like, I always get drugs and guns. You know what I mean? He's like, oh, this car is like fucking sweet or whatever. He's like, man, I want to like lube up and like fuck your muffler. I was like, oh, wow. He's like very specific. Really is. Which, you know, at the point, like, up to that point, John's cool about things, and he's like, nah, I'll let this guy fuck my car or whatever. I was just like, what the fuck? I was like, it's so random, right? And then, too, you know, like, he challenges him because he sees this happen earlier. He's like, well, I'll challenge you to, like, one-on-one combat.
Yeah.
And, I mean, like, to me, like, this is a feather in Jason Mantzoukas' cap, right? He's like, man, I got to kick Captain America's ass, Falcon's ass, you know what I mean? Like, I beat up an Avenger or whatever because he gets all doped up or something, right?
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
Like, yeah, he like he fucking like starts just like doing like lines real quick. Like
Darth Maul all over it, dude.
I just love like that was like his pregame to the fight. I was like, let me just fucking snort a couple of lines, get all fucking coked out crazy or whatever. Yeah, he's like, what does he say here? Joe says he's like, guys, that's just more drugs, right? Yeah, and he says, dude, straight up whips John.
Yeah, I was like, yeah. Damn.
And he's got it because really, even he said fuck? He tells Quiet, he's like, man, this guy looks like 100 pounds. Like I could just blow him over or whatever. Which again, this is like a kind of a beefier Anthony Mackie, not buff, but he definitely looks like he probably looks like he's weighing about 220 right there. Like he looks chunky, you know what I mean? Like not fat, but like he's doughy in the middle. He's not ripped, you know what I mean? Like I was like, oh, it's kind of how I look without a shirt, you know? You know? So I was like, all right. But again, this is Captain America right now. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, this guy's an Avenger. You know what I mean? I was like, he got his fucking ass kicked. So, yeah. So that's happening. And at the same time, Quiet's trying to, I guess, find them a way out.
You know what
I
mean? She does.
And she does.
She does.
And what did you think, AA? Was John wrong to not want to give up the car?
I should have just left.
It should have just left, right? Saved his own skin and, you know, she's hot. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but delivery to me.
You've been banging?
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
I'm like, hey, funny.
And I was a little bit lost on that part, AA. I will say that. Like, so they stripped the car, or they have the car, but they didn't find the package?
I guess not.
Oh, because they hid it out front.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
And again, too, couldn't remember that when Stone got the car. Right. He didn't get the package either when Stone didn't get the package?
Yeah, I was kind of lost on that, too. Yeah.
Yeah. John Doe, the Milkman, is very, you know, Han Solo-ish. And Evelyn is kind of like his Millennium Falcon, though. So, I mean, like, maybe if we put it that way.
Sure.
I kind of could see it. I was like...
I mean, don't get me wrong. When... You know, we kind of gave my blue car away. I was a little like, uh-oh. You know, I was a little mad.
That was the first Friday Night Mobile.
Yeah, I was like, eh. You know, it was going on almost 10 years with that car.
Yeah,
You know, so yeah, okay.
All right, we can kind of see John's point here. Now again, I don't know if I'd risk my life for it. I mean, maybe they would have found a way to like armor up, come back, maybe come back with those.
Yeah, maybe
those trailer the. Big rig chicks or something. Like they needed help because they were outmanned, outgunned, out everything.
He couldn't take out Preacher either.
Yeah, no, he not coked up Preacher. He didn't have no Captain America. John didn't have nothing for his ass. I'll tell you that. Joe says, "Let's see Chuck take off your shirt." Hey. All right, now you're getting somewhere. Joe. Make this show rated R. This show is a family show, Joe. All right. It says I could be wrong, but the car ends up.
Okay.
But he ends up with the car.
It's a game car.
Oh, okay, cool. Oh, okay, nice. The one that they end up with, which when the next episode's called Roadkill, which is what they named that car when we get there. And I should have put more pictures of the cars in, but I didn't, so I apologize for that, guys.
Or Evelyn.
Or Evelyn, I know. See, fucked up. See, I was like, man, I don't have enough slides. You know what I mean? Anywho, go ahead, AA. So
yeah, so, you know, it all starts off. He shoots the gas tank of Evelyn. It blows up. All the holy men leave, but, you know, John's really upset because... Evelyn's gone.
Well, yeah, she's dead. You know what I mean? And you feel like, man, fucking kind of sucks. Again, I would feel that way I felt this way every time they would blow up the fucking Enterprise. I was like, oh, man.
Yeah, so that's the way it ends. He has a little memorial for Evelyn, and then we go to Roadkill.
Yeah, episode 9. And so, too, right now, you know, Quiet's feeling some kind of way because, you know, he had an opportunity to escape with her, uh-huh, or whatever. He refused that opportunity. She gets the package. She's like, fuck this. I'll take the chance. I'll get in and get the place. And she's in a piece of shit car or whatever. But, you know, for her, it's a means to an end. And then what go ahead, double A, with what happens next.
Yeah, they get rescued by the convoy. Watts's convoy. Yes. They reconnect.
Yes.
She tells John that she's pissed off because he chose Evelyn,
right,
you know, over her. They thought they were partners, mm-hmm, you know, everything equal, you know.
And he's trying to make good, but it's kind of not going over.
The convoy gets under attack from Stone. they get the new car. They name it Roadkill. Then they go into Stone's blockade, and they are all attacking. They're starting to get attacked until Sweet Tooth comes out.
Yes, fucking Sweet Tooth shows up to kind of like, well, you think even the playing field, but then you really just find out that Sweet Tooth is fucking completely nuts.
He's nuts.
If we didn't know that already, I mean, we're like, I think you're kind of getting a little bit endeared to him, but then we see like, okay, no, you can't trust the fucking mad dog. You know what I mean? So, which he clearly was. And that takes us right into the final episode, episode 10.
Yeah, so they're at the racetrack. They beat Stone. They give him the option, like, John actually like throws like a little pickaxe and right here.
The little hatchet.
Yeah, it's like really deep, but it doesn't kill Stone.
Right.
But then she gives him the option that he gave her.
Right.
You know, one bullet, boom.
Yeah.
Now we hear a shot though, but we don't see a body.
And I think that Stone is too arrogant and cowardly to fucking blow his brains out. Yeah. So,
but man, that's gonna be a nasty wound to heal up, though.
Absolutely, yeah. And what happens in this episode to Sweet Tooth?
He tries to get Stu to kill Mike.
Right.
That doesn't happen. And they instead shoot Sweet Tooth.
Yeah. And again, guys, there are parts we're skipping over, like obviously what happens to Sweet Tooth's followers, and like, you know,
get killed.
But again, more reason for you to watch it and pick up on these other parts that are missing for sure. But yeah, Stu doesn't kill Mike or whatever, and to Sweet Tooth's, you know, dismay or whatever. So, you know, again, we're finding more too. Also, we finally see the flaming clown head, which is kind of one of Sweet Tooth's iconic things from the game, was they had this like flame hair, which I was like, damn, his head burned for a long time without, you know, like burning.
So I was wondering about that too, until my friend told me, because he plays a game, apparently I think he has a little backstory in the game.
Okay.
So he wins the first, I guess, Twist of Metal, mm-hmm, and Calypso gives him the wish, where it's like, okay, you know, you can have anything you want. Which I didn't understand that at the very end of this episode. I didn't understand until he told me. So I was like, oh, wow, that's like for real, for real.
Yeah.
The whole wish thing, that's for real.
Oh, wow.
Okay. I was like, okay, that's... So he wishes to be the star of Twisted Metal.
Yeah.
And so he kind of becomes, I guess, this kind of like supernatural kind of character.
Interesting.
With the fire head.
Okay.
Because me and my wife were like, how the fuck is he on fire? It's not going through.
Right.
So after he told me that, I was like, okay, that he's probably not dead.
Yeah.
You know,
there's more to him than that. So, okay, that's kind of cool.
So that's what he told me. He goes, that's what his wish was, and that's why every time in the game, he's always popping up. Yeah.
And Joe comments right here, he says, bro, Sweet Tooth with the fire head. He says, that's straight from the game. He says, the ending was the most like the game, I thought. And then he says, the wish is from the game, and you get that.
And you get that, but the wish you get is a little bit twisted.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But see, I was like when Neve Campbell says it, kind of like, yeah, I was like, a wish?
Yeah.
Like what are you talking about? Like,
right.
Like, you get your heart's desire, like, huh? Like, we're going into, like, the supernatural.
Yeah, now you're bleeding into something else where you're like, what is there, like...
Because I was like, that can't be what she meant. Like, it can't be, like, a wish. Like,
Right.
You know, I was like, huh? So, until he told me about the game, and I was kind of like, okay. So, I guess that is a thing in a game.
Okay.
Okay.
That'll be interesting to see how that plays out.
Right? I was kind of like,
in a season two, for sure, yeah. Especially you have someone like, you know, Sweet Tooth, psychotic, getting a wish like that, you'd be like, what the fuck? You know what I mean? So, well, you know, that'd be a kind of wish, right? You know what I mean?
Yeah, so after all that said and done, they go to New San Francisco. Mm-hmm. You know, she's super happy. Neve Campbell's super happy. He came back within 10 days.
Mm-hmm.
delivers the package, and he's about to enter with Quiet when they tell him, nope, it's only you.
Right.
We don't know her.
Right.
We only made this deal with her.
Mm-hmm.
She kind of sacrifices, like, kind of shoots him and says, you know, go, you know, I'll be all right. Right? Like, she kind of,
yes,
know, just go.
Right. You know, she's telling John, you know, don't give up this because of me or whatever. This is what you wanted. This is what you were here for, whatever. And she goes as far as to pull a gun on him. And she's like, and he's like, you know, no, like, we'll just, if you can't come in, I'm not going to go in either. We'll be out here. And then she shoots his ass.
Yeah, because she's like, you know, this is what you want. You know,
this
is what you've been talking about the whole time.
Right. It makes sense.
Yeah. So then they show John. He's kind of enjoying the life, but then, you know, just like everything else, it just starts becoming routine.
Yeah.
He's kind of starting to miss the road. You know, he's just kind of doing the same shit. He's going on a date.
Mm-hmm.
He's finally having pizza for the first time.
Yeah.
You know, but he's not really enjoying it without Quiet. He's missing her a lot.
Absolutely.
Meanwhile, her, at the same time, she's stealing deliveries from Milkman. And she's giving it to all the people on the outside.
Kind of being like a Robin Hood. Yes. Like, you know, at first he's like, they thinking, oh, she'll become a milkman. But then she's like, nah. She's like, it's just the inside people getting what they want. She's like, what about all the people suffering out here? So she's giving out the food supplies and all that or whatever, which is going to fuck things up. You know what I mean? Like, okay.
Yeah, it really is.
There's a system, but you're fucking it up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And so then we see, too, that Neve Campbell, the package was ice cream.
Yes.
But, again, that wasn't kind of like the whole point. The whole point was
to see if he could do it.
He could do it and come back.
Right.
With, you know, and she's happy. She's like, all right. And she's setting up the whole town.
Mm-hmm.
To like kind of like play him up, like, man, he's this great driver, he's a great hero, but it's all staged, it's all fake.
His friends, the dates, like everything. Now, ultimately, Double A, what does she want him to drive for them for?
That Twisted Metal competition.
Oh, the competition. That's right. That's right.
Yes.
Yeah. And again, yeah, like Joe mentioned earlier, that last episode. And again, from my knowledge of the game, when I saw that setup, I was like, oh, okay, this is where they're going right into the
but
game.
But she wasn't white either. She was like, you'll find out about your family, which she does. Apparently, he lived there.
Yeah.
He takes him to the house.
I was curious about that. Yeah. He's had this photo throughout. We didn't really mention that, but he's had this photo throughout where the parents are burned out and you just see him, but it's obviously two people there.
And his sister.
And a little bit of a house, right? So then, like, you know, she's like, no, this is where you grew up. This was your house, blah, blah. But I don't know, Double A.
The memories start flooding.
They do, right? Yeah. But I also was like, you know, because also, too, we find out that, you know, he wakes up, you know, in this world and has just a bit of amnesia. And all he can has that he finds is like that picture or whatever before he runs into the Evelyn car and kind of starts fending for himself. Real quick, Joseph, he's never played that story in that story game through. He said he just liked the car battles, okay. Which I totally get because I was never into like racing games, but I would play them sometimes just to crash the cars. But yeah, so the memories start to flood back.
I think
that really was it. Like he really did live in New San Francisco.
I think so.
But then why? How did he end up on the outside? Like, did the parents try to leave?
Well, remember, remember they do try to leave.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's when he just stays in Evelyn. I guess he just keeps moving. Or he's on his own, remember?
Right. But, well, I guess we don't know yet what happened to the parents initially.
No.
Right? Okay. And the sibling or whatever. So.
Well, yeah, we find out what happens with the sister. Remember, she meets Quiet.
Yes, that's right.
Remember?
That's right.
At the very end.
At the very end, yeah, okay.
And you're like, holy shit, the sister.
Yeah, she leads a group.
Yeah.
That's right. That's like the end credit scene almost.
Yeah.
So there's definitely some cool stuff too that there's like room for a season two to play out on, you know what I mean? For sure.
We find out Neve Campbell, you know, she's like, okay, he still wants to leave. And she's like, no, you're not going anywhere. We thought this would finally keep it here, but no, you're gonna be my driver in this Twisted Metal competition.
Yes,
where, you know, I'm gonna win, you're gonna win me that wish or anything I desire.
Which, okay, so then again, now we're kind of like bordering on like, what could it be? Is it the supernatural? Is it like that kind of thing? That's interesting. Also too, right now we think that Sweet Tooth is dead, but we get another end kind of credit scene where Stu and Mike are kind of just like growing up again because apparently they've been friends since like the third grade.
Yeah, long time.
So that's a little bit more fucked up when you see the kind of back and forth between them because there's several times where Mike kind of fucks over Stu and then, you know, there's, you know, Stu continuously bails out Mike, you know, even from Sweet Tooth. you know, and it just still kind of keeps looking out for him, even though he's not a killer. But every chance Mike kind of gets to, like, where he needs to keep himself alive, he's willing to fuck over Stu, whatever.
Well, yeah, so, fuck over Stu, but he does save him quite a few
times. Yeah, he does, too, yeah. And at this point, when there's no danger, they're kind of just palling around, right? They're like, okay, cool, we're finally just chilling, we're drinking beer, they're just hanging out, whatever. Yeah. They feel like they've gotten away a little bit from some of the craziness, until what happens, AA?
Sweet Tooth comes out. He kills Mike and drags Stu away.
Yeah, we hear the gunshot, and shoots him, like, on top of the head or something like that, right? Yeah, and he drags Stu away, like,
and that's we're not where done yet,
hanging out. Yeah,
you know, maybe Sweet Tooth has already done the whole Calypso shit.
And have the immortal on this other side. Yeah. It,
like I said, I don't know anything about the game.
Nor do
That's just what my friend told me, that apparently he's like the first winner of the Twisted Metal, you know, competition, and that was his wish. So.
Okay. Okay.
And it kind of makes sense with this, with his fucking past, where he wanted to be the star, where he was a star, and then he got surpassed.
Yeah.
You know,
so. No, definitely. That definitely does make a lot of sense, for sure. And we cannot echo Joe's sentiments here enough ourselves, but definitely tuning in for season two.
I mean,
Joe,
it was fun. Again, it's kind of like me and CM were like, you know, CM Tony is like, how do we sleep on this? I go, man, I really don't know.
Yes. Yeah.
It was fun. Like I said, it's like each chapter was really good. It was like you got a start and you got a finish at just about every episode, but it left you wanting more. It left you wanting that next episode.
Yes.
You know?
Yes. And I don't feel like it ever dragged.
Yeah,
it
wasn't lagged. Like those first two episodes where you're just like, is it going to pick up?
You know, no, not at all.
You have to wait like one or two episodes. No, this, like, right away, it tells you what's happening and it introduces you to a whole bunch of great characters.
Yeah. And again,
when Neve Campbell's talking to him, it shows kind of like who they're gearing up for the competition.
Oh yes, yeah.
You know, it shows Watts, it shows John.
Right.
I forgot who the other characters are, but they start showing all the drivers.
You almost get to see, like, okay, some of the people they've encountered are gonna be back in it. Because Watts has this really cool, like, Formula One racer car.
Yes.
And does Amber die?
No, she lives.
Okay, she's just like she hurt. Lives.
Yeah, but they patch her up.
Right, right. She was pretty, like, upset about that. Like, but you're like, oh man, fuck, like, they killed her. Yeah. So there's a lot of great stuff I think that there's to look forward to in season two. I also think that season one is
highly with the sister. You got the sister coming out. You're like, okay, shit, John has a sister. You got Sweet Tooth back.
Yeah.
You don't know about Agent Stone. He could still very well be alive.
I definitely think he's alive still. Yeah.
So,
and if he knows that they're in this competition and he wants a chance at revenge, I think I could see him getting into that competition.
And obviously, we want to see them to reconnect.
Oh, yeah. So, totally. Yeah. Totally. And we want to see, obviously, you know, Sweet Tooth and the ice cream truck are probably going to get souped up.
Oh,
Roadkill is going to get souped up.
Especially now that Joe told us that that's, you know, the car.
Right. Yeah.
That's the actual car, not Evelyn.
Not so Evelyn. Cool. Yeah. And again, what they're going to do with everyone else, the Watts' Formula One race car, or what else are they going to introduce, maybe from other games? So, I mean, guys, it's just, again, I cannot say enough how much it was a lot of fun. I haven't watched a show like this in a while that I felt like instant gratification, good action, good characters, solid storytelling. And again, you know, the more I think about it, the producers of things like Zombieland and
Deadpool
is like, they're kind of all about that. Two things, you know, the Deadpool movies and Zombieland is very much like, you know, okay, here's the story, you know what I mean? And then, like, boom, boom, boom with the jokes, but then the action is still killing, you know? As I was just re-looking at some of the Deadpools, because my nephew, my sister actually let him watch those. One and two, whatever, you know, which, you know, I think the sex stuff is, like, very kind of tongue-in-cheek, but I think she has him cover his eyes during that stuff, But as far as, like, I mean, I was looking at the action parts and I was like, well, the action parts, like, the Deadpool fighting is, like, really bad.
It really is.
Yeah.
Yeah, it really
fucking
is.
Ryan Reynolds really kicks ass. You know what I mean? So, Joe right here mentions the race car was badass. Definitely regarding Watts' race car. That was fucking very cool. And her hairy armpits, too.
You know what? I'm cool with it because
it's post-apocalyptic world. Yeah. You're not
Where
thinking about
the razor.
Yeah. And even if you did, I mean, like, are you going to use it for that? I mean, fuck the shaving. You know?
Yeah.
Maybe Amber likes the smelly pits. You know what I mean?
Like, well, I'm sure they have flowers to counteract.
Or a deodorant.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm sure nobody's using it. It's just around. Yeah. You know what I mean? So if they could find gas, I mean, like,
they apparently, like, everything's not really a short supply.
Right.
You know, it's like everything is just kind of there.
Yeah. And again, like they said, they walled up the cities. So that's kind of like, okay, maybe certain things stayed in abundance or whatever. And I kind of like that some people have, like, we have this, we have this. Uh-huh. You know what I mean? So it's kind of cool.
Yeah.
But yeah, totally great suggestion from AA. Again, I mean, I'm keen enough to check out maybe some of the games now. If they've got them on a new system, I'll just play it just for fun or whatever to see what it's like. But the show fucking kicked ass. Anthony Mackie was great. Like, he was so good in this again. Like, I was like, I mean, I think one of my first texts to you about the show was, I was like, I like him so much better in this than I do in fucking, and I hate to say that because I don't dislike Falcon. And I did not dislike him as Cap or Falcon in the Winter Soldier, but he's very like,
there's more, you see more of him
right here. He's very dry in those, and he's not dry at all in this. He's great. Again, I can't say enough. He's fucking
He really takes over this show. Hey, Jeremy, what's up?
Jeremy in the house. He says, what's up, fellas? A little late. Jeremy, tell us about, did you watch Twisted Metal on Peacock? And also, if you didn't, did you play the games? And what was your thoughts on the games? And how do you think maybe it would transfer into a show? Because let us tell you, it's fucking a great show. Jeremy, I know you're a huge fan of The Boys, you know, things like that. So I know that you will love this show, man. But I want to know, like, from your gaming side, what about the games, if you had any interaction with them or played them? I know you're more of like a new gamer. This game has been out since 95, but I know there were very, very many different versions of it. So, but yeah, AA. So again, this one premiered in June, right? And like Joe said, they were working on it during COVID. So maybe it was done a long time. Have you heard any word on potential? It
just, December got renewed.
Okay, barely in December it got renewed. Okay.
So I mean, I don't know when they're gonna,
how long we'd have to wait.
Especially with that writer's strike that was still going on.
Right.
So
it makes me wonder if, you know, maybe it was something that was gonna go back, because I feel like things that were being shot during COVID that barely came out have been out off for a while. So maybe it's like close to being restarted again. Do you know, I don't know if you would know this, AA, but do you know if it dropped all at once on Peacock or did it come out?
I
want
to say it did.
It did? Okay.
I want to say it did.
Yeah. Okay. And I didn't hear anybody talking about it. I knew of it and I was like, oh, Twisted Metal, that's kind of cool. And I was like, you know, like, interesting that they adapted that game.
Like,
or whatever.
I really didn't know what it was about, honestly. I didn't know until, like, I read, like, I just did it because Anthony Mackie, right?
Yeah.
So, but when I was reading it, I was kind of like, oh man, my wife's going to love this.
Yeah.
Right? So I told her, I go, hey, you know, honey, do you want to see this? I showed her a trailer, and right away she was like into it, and so we saw the first episode and she loved it. Like I said, it's so cool kind of seeing that outside perspective where she's never heard of the franchise at all. She's seen it and she's loving it, you know, so it doesn't matter if it's like a Nintendo game or not. She's loving this.
Yeah.
You know, so that
a totally like a new clear perspective.
Yeah, like this is all her.
Yeah.
Dystopian. It's fun. It's kind of like The Walking Dead. You're getting introduced to characters, but you're meeting communities, but you're doing it in one episode, and then you're on to the next one.
And much more like, not that it's not serious, but it's just much more light than, it's not as heavy-handed as The Walking Dead.
She's already like rewatched it like quite a few times. She's went back already a few times and watched it already.
Yeah. I mean, part of me, like, I finished it when we decided, like, last week or whatever, but I rewatched episodes a couple of times, like, and I meant to just rewatch, like, a little bit, and then I ended up watching, like, 1, 2, 3, and I was like, oh, damn, I already watched, like, halfway through again. And I was like, it's just such an easy watch. It's such a fun watch. I was laughing still. I was still enjoying it. I was, like, I was picking up on little, like, little jokes that I maybe have missed the first time around. So I was like, it was easily, like, again, guys, you all know what I would say, like, rewatchability, you know, would you buy it? I mean, like, in this case, it's on Peacock, so, you know, you're not buying, like, a physical copy, but I would, a fucking sweet-ass, sweet-tooth steelbook, I'd buy that.
And we didn't really say it either, but, like, so, like, Peacock is having, I don't know if they're going to do this deal again, but they were having, like, exclusive games just on Peacock, and they were, like, advertising, like, if you get Peacock now, you can get it for, like, $5.99 for, like, the year or some shit like that.
Yeah,
I mean, they were really heavily, I was like, man, that's a sweet deal for anyone who doesn't have Peacock.
Absolutely.
And to watch this show too, you know.
Real quick, some comments. Jeremy says, I didn't play the games. He says, I didn't watch, but the games are amazing. Yeah. Sweet Tooth, of course, is the best character, LOL, he says, but very different from the game. Not in a bad way, though. Okay, very cool. Joe says, I thought I might have mentioned it if I watched it at the beginning and rewatched the last three today in the background while I was cleaning. Nice. And then Joe says,
it's funny if you're a fan of the game, but it's not necessary to enjoy the show.
Yeah, not at all, because, I mean, we obviously didn't play it. All I knew of that was Twisted Metal was a game. I knew that it was about, like, vehicles, vehicle-based, and I think in my mind I knew it was, like, kind of derby-ish.
I knew the game. I didn't know what it was about, though.
Yeah, and if you would have asked me, like, name one character from Twisted Metal, I would have said Sweet Tooth. That's the one that I knew, whatever, was it.
I remember Cloud, but I couldn't even tell you the name, though.
Yeah, that's the one thing I knew. So I was like, oh, are they going to show him, and, like, what's he about? I mean, like, and then, I mean, it could have probably gone all kinds of ways, because I saw some of his early, like, renderings, like, in the game, and I was like, yeah, it looks all right, but the way that it's done in this is very badass. So it's very enjoyable, very easy to jump into. Joe says Royal Rumble and WrestleMania are coming up. Yes, that is Double A next weekend.
Royal Rumble next Saturday, and then WrestleMania is probably April.
Okay, there you go. Yeah, Joe, I know you'll be watching as a wrestling fan. Any predictions, Joe, on Rumble winners? I'd like to hear that. And Double A, speaking of predictions, what about you? What are your thoughts on season two? And where do you see the show going and the characters going in this?
I guess it's
going
to be all about that derby.
Okay.
I don't know how that's going to work. I don't know how that works. I don't know if they all kill each other. You know, okay. That's going to suck too, because, you know, you like the character Watts.
Right.
You like John.
Right.
You know, Sweet Tooth always is, you know, that kind of, you don't know what he's going to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
Stu, what's going to happen with Stu? You know, right. So.
Maybe it'll be about them kind of like finding their vehicles, souping up their vehicles.
And then John Fister, that's a new wrinkle.
Yeah, so. Absolutely, yeah. And then, too, I kind of want to know more about, like, well, what was up with that house and the parents and, like, what led to that, you know, his eventual being out there in the world. So definitely some more things to be, you know, unfolded as it goes
along. So they got a lot. They got a lot to work with.
I think so. Well, definitely if they do it in the way they did this with short episodes and 10 episodes, it's like, you know, you can, you know, squeeze two or three episodes.
I saw this like in 2 days, and I probably could have seen it in one day. We didn't start off so late.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Same thing. I think if I'd have started this like on a Saturday morning and just had nothing to do and just watch it, I could have easily watched it all day, no doubt. Like, or, well, it wouldn't even have been all day. It would have been like half a day. And easy. And I would have easily told someone, you need to watch it. You want to watch it? I'll watch it with you. And I'm like, I would sit and watch this again with anyone that wanted to see it easily.
Joe says another reason to have Peacock.
Absolutely.
He says Raven's people too. What's up with that?
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They were all scared of her.
Yeah, they were like.
Yeah, it's kind of like that too. To kind of like unveil all of that. Like, how did she have this much power?
Yeah.
Why are they scared of her?
She's ruling with like an iron fist in there. Like, if she got nukes or something like that, what's she got her finger on?
When you say she looked really damn good though, I was like.
Yeah, she did. I was like, all right, never can. But what does he say? He's like a really intimidating little white lady. But yeah, guys, overall, you know, Twisted Metal on Peacock, absolutely great show. I could not recommend it enough.
Yeah.
It gets my seal of approval, if that's anything, and the highest, you know, recommend to watch it I can give. I'm like, dude, if there's something out there you're looking to watch, then watch this.
Yep.
Because you'll enjoy it. I recommended it to Marquise because I think he did play some of the games.
Okay.
Since he's a longtime PlayStation guy, so I'm sure he probably worked his way through everything at one time or another. So he was asking me recently, he's like, what is it on? I was telling him, and he was like, okay. And I was just like, yeah, it's like quick episodes, like easy, easy watch, you know, too. And again, done in a way that it's very palatable, you know, so. Joe says, fuck you, Bill.
Fucking Bill. Yeah. It's like, what the hell is that?
Yeah, know, man.
Up his ass.
Totally, man.
It was good. Each episode had a different, you know, cast. You got to see Stone's background, Sweet Tooth's background, John's background, Quiet's background. You know, you got to see everything. So it was just really fun. It's just...
Yeah.
You saw a lot in 10 episodes in like 5 hours total time.
Yeah.
You saw a lot.
I mean, I feel like it was a good setup too, to like, you'll go in knowing all these characters into season two. You know, if it was like a, you know, a movie. It could have easily been like a, you know, prequel or whatever. And like, okay, here's all you need to know.
I think it was. Yeah. I think it was a prequel.
Yeah. Here's all the players. Yeah. And now we're going to get into like the twisted metal. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, I loved it. I can't wait. I can't wait for season two. So that's one I'll be definitely looking for. Joe says, another great episode, thanks, boys. Sir. Appreciate that. Joe, looking forward to you getting back on the mic soon with Now Watch This. Whatever form or fashion that comes in, we can't wait to hear it, man. Anything else, Double A, before we get out of here?
Check it out. Watch it. It's fun.
Absolutely, guys. If there's nothing else, Joe says, real quick, he says, I ain't sitting 3 hours for Flower Moon, but I'll do 5 hours of Twisted Metal. Absolutely.
That's funny.
Absolutely. That's funny. Good call on that, Joe, no doubt. Jeremy says, gotta watch it. Only seen one episode.
You'll see it. It just flies by.
Yeah, man. I mean, again, if you haven't been wanting to watch it after seeing that one, I mean, dude, yeah, let me know. We'll make sure you get to see it for sure. Guys, something we like to say here on Just Another Friday Night at the end of every show is like to remind all of you guys, if there's something that you want to do, something that you want to accomplish, a hope, a dream, whatever it may be, go out and do it. There's no time like the present, right, Double A?
Nope.
Guys, seize the day, right? Carpe diem. You know, in this show, seems like several people are looking to seize the day. Obviously, oh, yeah. You know, John with having to survive in the post-apocalyptic world and making his way from being like, how old do you think he was? Like 10 or something?
Probably.
Even that old? Probably. He starts driving the damn car.
He looks really young.
He looks pretty young. Yeah, the kid. Also, too, you know, Quiet, obviously, with her revenge. Yeah. You know what I mean? So, and Sweet Tooth, definitely. When he wanted to be a star, he made himself the star. He definitely seized the day.
He really did.
The other thing we like to say, guys, is to remind you all, like the great Captain Steve Rogers says in Endgame when he reminds the Avengers before they go back on the time heist, that they must do whatever it takes. Guys, sometimes in order to accomplish that hope or dream, you must do whatever it takes. So we suggest you do both. Seize the day, guys. Do whatever it takes. I feel like everyone in Twisted Metal is doing whatever it takes. Like when he holds up the dog food, he's like, tonight we feast. I was like, how many people are in there? One bag ain't gonna feed that many people. I was like, but all right, you know what I mean? So guys, check it out. Twisted Metal on Peacock. Definitely worth it. If it's the price Double A says, that's a steal.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know if it will be still. But.
Yeah. And like Joe said earlier, and Dean, it's like you get The Office, you get Parks and Rec, you get Psych, you get.
Yeah, and then I've heard great things about Ted, the series of Ted.
Oh, yeah. I've been reading people saying that it's really funny too, whatever. Yeah. And I was kind of, I saw that come out and I was like, that looks cheesy. I'm not going to watch that. Like,
but everyone says it's fucking funny. So
they might end up covering that if it ends up being that good. So check it out, guys.
And like you said, what's cool about it too is the movies. All the ads are in the beginning, and then after that, you just see the whole fucking movie.
Yeah.
All the way through.
Which, great job on Peacock on that.
Great
put it up
job
front.
On Peacock.
Don't spurs it out through the movie. Yeah. I'll watch it at the beginning.
That's great.
If you're going to force me to watch commercials, fine, just put them up front.
Yeah, I'm like, that's cool. Shit.
Absolutely, guys. All right, guys. Well, we'll be back again next week to talk with you all here live on Just Another Friday Night. We want to say thanks to our Collecting Weekly auxiliary audience. We're streaming also, you know, simultaneously on their channel and their page. So we appreciate those guys, Zach and Dean and all the boys over there and all of you guys that popped in earlier to give us a boost up our audience here. So next week, not sure what we're doing. We'll talk about it. We'll figure it out. And then we'll bring back and talk about it with you guys then. Jeremy says, later, fellas, and good night. Jeremy, good night, and good night to all of you, the Friday Nighters, the Friday Night Faithful. Seize the day. Do whatever it takes. And be good to each other.
Yeah.
All right, guys. We'll see you next week. Have a good night.